rivalry. Every week in the SEC is life and death.
Where football is not just a game,
but a religion.
We wear our school colors like a badge of honor.
Go Tigers!
They wear the uniform to uphold our passion.
Go Vols!
Hey, fighting Tigers, fight all the way.
Their passion is endless.
Our time here is finite.
Rocky Top, you'll always be. Arms we love to wear.
To wear the jersey.
To represent the colors.
To pursue the dream.
To live the fantasy.
I will always be a Tiger.
The Vols will always be a part of me. Don't ever underestimate the heart of the Volunteers.
One play to win the SEC East for Tennessee. Big pressure. Big sack from behind. The game is over.
We're all in.
Shemeka's bird. He is interfered.
Tigers to the end.
Intercepted. Arkansas wins.
No regrets. This is my last chance.
My final opportunity.
To win.
To play.
For the LSU Tigers.
For the Tennessee Volunteers.
For the SEC Championship.
For the SEC Championship.
Georgia Dome in downtown Atlanta and the 16th Southeastern Conference Championship game. This afternoon, the SEC Championship features the Volunteers of Tennessee against the Tigers of LSU. Good afternoon, everybody. Vern Lundquist with Gary Danielson and Tracy Wolfson. Welcome to Atlanta. These two teams come into this game from diametrically opposed emotional states. Consider Tennessee. They had to win five in a row to get here. Yes, they had some breaks. They created others on their own. They come in feeling really good about themselves. Consider LSU. 1 week ago, they lost their chance at a national title. Only 3 hours ago, their head coach seems to have confirmed his status as the next current and next head coach at LSU. But it has been a crazy week for them. I heard a young co-ed dressed in LSU colors this morning say to her date, bummer. It's how does this affect these young men, Gary?
Well, you know, we've been with them all year, right, Bern? I'm exhausted. And I, you know, you cannot hide from the modern media. It goes through every nook and cranny, and I'm sure there's no way that LSU and Les Miles could hide all this, you know, on the periphery of this football team. But sometimes this football team for the play, this football field right here is a sanctuary for these players, and I think this team will look forward to coming out on the field today.
Well, Gary, they also have the question mark involving their quarterback, Matt Flynn.
Yeah, I was ready to talk about Glenn Dorsey saying he's the key, but I really think when a quarterback is nicked, this is the key guy. Matt Flynn, it appears that shoulder that he injured against Arkansas is going to keep him, at least early in the game, in emergency status. That means that Ryan Perilloux, the USA Today Player of the Year, is going to be the quarterback. Now, if I'm LSU, I'm going to try to convince Ryan Perilloux that that's middle Tennessee on the other side of the line, not Tennessee, because Ryan Perilloux in his one game carved up middle Tennessee. We all know Tennessee's better than middle Tennessee, but Ryan Perilloux now, he must rise up and take this game over and show that he's the quarterback everybody thought he was.
Well, we talked about tumult associated with LSU. How about this season for Tennessee? Three defeats by a total of 77 points.
You know, everybody was ready to give up on this football team and all that doom and gloom. And you know what Tennessee did? They went to work. and the season started the way it's ended. Eric Ainge is going to have to be the guy. They don't match up, Tennessee doesn't, in every position. But sometimes a quarterback can have a special day and carry his team. If Eric Ainge can do that, he can improve the matchup on the field and make his team have a chance to win this game.
And his team is first on the field. A large group of supporters here to welcome the Volunteers. Meet the Tigers of Louisiana State University when we return to the SEC Championship in Atlanta. Well, they jumped the gun on us. Here come the Tigers of Louisiana State.
An unprecedented move. Why did you feel 2 hours before the championship game that you needed to make a statement?
Our football team was, diverted, and I wanted to address some misinformation that was out. I am the head coach at LSU. I'll be the head coach at LSU, and will be next year.
You will be the head coach next year.
Absolutely.
That was, as you could see, a couple of hours ago. For more on the story, let's go down to Tracy Wilson.
Thanks, guys. I spoke with LSU official Herb Vincent before the game, and he told me that they were negotiating with Les Miles' agent late into the night and early this morning. He said they agreed on a contract amendment, and they will announce the terms later this week. I asked him, could that change? He said nothing's been signed yet, but that would be extremely unfaithful. Guys.
All right. Thank you, Trace. Tennessee has won the toss. They will receive when we return. CBS Sports coverage of the SEC Championship game, presented by Dr. Pepper, is sponsored by Bud Light, Pontiac, Sonic, and by Dr. Pepper. Back in Atlanta, where Tennessee won the toss, elected to receive to begin the game. Experience SEC college football on CBS, brought to you in high definition by Sony. This is the 30th meeting overall between these two, fifth appearance in this game by Tennessee, fourth for LSU. The Volunteers won two titles in the 90s. LSU won twice. They seem to appear here every odd number year, 2001, 2003, 2005, and here they are with Sean Godet getting set to kick off. The deep man, Dennis Rogan and Lennon Creer. Short. Oh, my goodness. Almost recovered by Chad Jones.
Almost caught by Chad Jones, but it's going to be a penalty because Tennessee signaled for a fair catch, and Jones impeded the ability for Tennessee to do it. That's what I believe. It's a heads-up play by the Tennessee, and it could be also offsides. There was offsides. See, the player signal, number 23, has it. It's Ricardo Kemp right there, and offsides.
And so,
see the right hand up in the air right there?
Yes.
There it is, and Chad Jones is tracking it down. Chad Jones, the baseball player safety, whiffed on that one, but it wouldn't have come.
Offside on the kicking team. Free kick out of bounds, untouched by the receivers. Kicking team, we're going to tack 5 yards on to the spot where the ball went out of bounds. First down.
That is Tom Ritter, our referee today. And the lineups, first of all, for the Volunteers, presented by Dr. Pepper. At quarterback, take a look at the number of times Eric Ainge has been sacked. Three.
I'm very envious of that.
The total for the team is 4. Scott, Parker, McNeil, McClendon, and Foster. The offensive line is Rogers, 2 tight ends, Brown and Cottom. The other wideout is Taylor, and the running back, Arian Foster. He's over 1,000 yards for the season. Ainge fakes, fires left side, caught by Lucas Taylor. That's his 72nd catch of the season. And it's a pickup of 14 yards.
He has maneuvered this team on that first drive, hasn't he? And he starts out hot again.
Really solid senior season. The young man who came back to Tennessee from his home in the Portland, Oregon area. Taylor with the first catch of the ball game. Double tight end set again. Here's the handoff to Foster. He finds room and rips up the middle inside the 40. This, at one point this season, was the top-ranked defense in the United States. They have really slipped because of injuries in part the last two games. Jackson Dorsey, Ricky Jean-Francois, has not played in a game this year, and he's getting the start tonight. Sanders, Beckwith, Highsmith, the linebackers, and the secondary, Zeenan, Danny McCray, for an injured Curtis Taylor, and here's the handoff on second down, right side. Foster leans down near the 35-yard line. Well, the last two games they played, Ole Miss and the three overtime loss to Kentucky, really has a problem.
I think there's two factors to look at that Bo Pelini knows in this game. Yes, the injuries were a big factor. Glenn Dorsey's not what he was. We will watch him early. And the other is both of those teams, Ole Miss with a scrambling quarterback and Arkansas, was very unique.
New quarterback in, Jonathan Crompton.
A runner.
And he's under center on third and two. Comes right, pre-snap penalty.
You could see he came in to run the ball. They don't want Eric Ainge getting hit, and Crompton comes in to run the ball on third and short.
We have timeout. Tennessee, that is their first charge timeout of this half.
Opening moments of the 16th SEC Championship game from the Georgia Dome in Atlanta. On the sidelines, the Matt Damon look-alike, Matt Flynn. Injured shoulder, hurt it twice, had to make trips to the locker room last week in that loss to Kentucky. Now, Gerald Jones is in at quarterback this time, the running wide receiver.
Yeah, the G-man formation.
And here's Jones, takes off left. What a lot of room he's got. First down at the 15-yard line.
Gerald Jones was a high school quarterback, just a freshman making the transition to wide receiver. They're going to give it the zone read. There's the guy they read. Watch, they wrote it down. In comes the defensive end, Pittman. Keep by Jones, and it looks like offensive coordinator David Cutcliffe has seen the last two games' tapes.
I think so. And a first down, Eric Ainge is back in. It was Jones who had one of the really important touchdown catches in the win over Kentucky last week. And now, do they have to use their second timeout?
No, it was they're going to redo the 25-second clock. They have to reset it.
Philip Fulmer. There's a man who is very familiar with the lives of cats and how many there are. Midseason, they were howling for him, for his job. Now they win five in a row, and there's talk from Mike Hamilton, the athletic director, about a contract extension and a raise. First down and 10. Foster knifes through and gets down to the 11-yard line.
Arian Foster is Tennessee's version of Jacob Hester. He reads the blocking very well, catches the ball out of the backfield, pass protection, and just is an all-around dependable football player.
Second down and 5. And this red zone offense, 68.5% touchdown percentage inside the 20. And on the opposite side of the ball, LSU has really been lenient. I'm trying to find the right word.
Yeah, the play clock is again malfunctioning.
Prior to the snap, we were buzzed from the replay booth.
All right, the replay official today is Ben Oldham. And apparently the communication need was involved a 25-second clock again.
Yeah, the clock is, was watching. I was watching it one time. It's 25. We got it in there. Oh, there we go.
Whoops.
The wrong side is going down.
There was a problem with the 25-second clock. We will replay second down.
And Vern, you're right on about LSU's red zone defense. It has been a problem all year, and it's not a good matchup against Tennessee.
Ames looks back at the Tennessee bench.
And he saw that LSU is going to bring pressure right here.
Two wides to the right, one off to the left. Ames back to throw. Oh, it's almost picked off. It's deflected, and that is a touchdown. Chris Brown, number 28, 11 yards, Volunteers first on the scoreboard. My goodness. Brown's sixth touchdown catch of the season. A senior who is from Louisiana. And Daniel Lincoln on for the extra point.
It was actually a perfect call by LSU. They go inside, but watch Kirsten Pittman right here. He starts there, but then he backs up to here to get the crossing route across. It should have been intercepted. In and then back out right there, and he misses the interception. A perfect defensive call, and Tennessee gets 7 points.
Boop, boop. Zip, 7-0. SEC Championship Diamond Moment presented by Kate Jewelers.
In 1997, Tennessee trailed Auburn by 6 in the fourth quarter, but Peyton Manning threw a 73-yard touchdown to give the Vols a 30-29 victory. The following season against Mississippi State, T. Martin threw 2 touchdown passes in the fourth, and Tennessee won 24-14 and followed the SEC title with a national championship 1 month later.
Chris Brown, the tight end, with the touchdown catch after Kirsten Pittman almost took it and went the other direction. 6 plays, 57 yards, took 3 minutes, and again, Tennessee has scored on its opening possession. Britton Colquitt will kick off. Trendon Holliday, who missed last week with an ankle sprain, he's got a touchdown return on a kickoff this year, as well as one last year. 5'5", 160 pounds. And he, as we have documented throughout this season, was the runner-up in the NCAA Division I 100-meter dash last spring. He'll take it from a yard deep. Runs into Tennessee traffic at the 23-yard line. And let's see who comes out. Will it be number 11? There's a player down for Tennessee at the 21. It's going to be Ryan Perilou. He's played one start this year, had a brilliant game against Middle Tennessee State. He has not seen much action in the last 5 weeks. He was suspended for a game because of a late night altercation in a parking lot of a place that serves adult beverages. Black, Johnson, Helms, Hitt, and Stewart, the offensive line. Doucette, Bird, Hester, Dixon, the tight end, and LaFell. So three wides, a running back, and this is Tremaine Johnson, the injured player for LSU.
He got basically a knockout blow. He was right in the middle of the wedge. Let's see if I can point him out to you. There he is, right there, number 47. Watch him get a kind of a right cross right to the chin here. Boom. Just out on his feet right there. First round knockout.
Mm. So here is Ryan Perilou. Grew up and played East St. John High School about a half an hour from downtown New Orleans. Signed initially with Texas, then transferred or decommitted. Here's the handoff to Hester Wright up the middle. And a quick opening strike for the Tigers of Louisiana State. 15-yard gain.
Well, we've done them six games, and every time you do them, this is what he does. He finds the hole, and he runs over people, and he makes first downs. He is something special. He will be playing football for a long time. That's my prediction.
First down and 10. Here's the handoff to Hester again. He goes right this time. Nothing's doing. Well, defensively for the Volunteers, and this secondary is a little suspect. Mitchell, Bolden, Dan Williams, who had the field goal block in the win over Kentucky, and Reynolds at the end. The linebackers in the middle. Gerard Mayo is having a wonderful year. McCoy and Carl on either side. Brett Benson is the guy who just got that shoulder and went backwards on the Jacob Hester run. Hefney, Berry, two freshmen starting in the secondary for Tennessee. Here's Perilou rolling out. Fires it. First catch. And loose down the sideline is Keith Zinger. Number 89, that's his second catch all year.
See, this is why this is such a good call right here, is because Zinger is the blocking tight end. Dixon, number 82, we had the camera on early, is the catching tight end, and then very poor tackling by that Tennessee secondary runs right through Hefney and Vincent.
Just a footnote. LSU has fumbled twice all year. All year. The two fumbles, one by Ryan Perilou, the other from Keith Zinger. Perilou pitches, and it's Keelan Williams to the 30-yard line. Ryan Perilou on in place of Matt Flynn. The Aggies had Brandon Stewart come on in the 98 Big 12 championship game. He replaced Randy McCown. Matt Mauk, very memorably for those of us at CBS when they won the SEC championship against Tennessee. And Matt Flynn replaced Jamarcus Russell in the Peach Bowl. Flynn on the sidelines in his senior season. High pass, incomplete. Intended for Doucette. Eric Berry was in the neighborhood.
And Eric Berry is a true freshman player that has started every football game for Tennessee. We saw him early against Florida when he had that long interception for a touchdown. And I'm telling you, he closed on that football. Now, here's the part, Matt Flynn on the bench. Here's the part that Matt Flynn will be most missed. Third and long.
Holiday is in. Perilou has backs in the eye. Hester is at fullback. Holiday the tailback. They hand it to Hester. He's got room. He's got a first down and out of bounds at the 13-yard line.
Well, that just can't happen. I mean, if you're Tennessee and you want to win this football game, you can't let them hand the ball off to the fullback. Good changeup by LSU. Last week, every time Hester got it fullback, they threw it. This time they hand him the ball. Great blocking at the end of the line. Again, Keith Zinger starting out with a good football game here.
Jonathan Hefney, the lone defender, and he did force him out of bounds, but it's a first down for the Tigers out of the gun this time. Perilou looks for a block. He got a little brush block from Doucette, and he's inside the 10.
I did ask offensive coordinator Gary Croton, what will he do if Perilou is a player all game? Will he rotate Andrew Hatch, the number three quarterback? And he told me, Gary, the only thing I worry about with Ryan is if he takes a lot of hits running the ball. I may bring in Hatch just to give him a breather, but it's going to be Ryan Perilou's game.
Second down and 4 at the 7. As we mentioned, he had one start this year. That was against Middle Tennessee.
Uncovered player in the left slot. No, they finally adjusted.
Yeah, that was Tolliver. Here's Perilou. Caught and dropped. Gerard Mayo had 19 tackles against Kentucky in the 4 overtime game last week.
See, now here's the challenge for LSU. With Perilou running this spread formation, Tennessee says, you're going to have to prove it to me that you're willing to throw the ball, because we're going to come at you and play the quarterback draw. If you throw it, you throw it. You might beat us. But John Chavis is going to put his money on the fact that you're going to run him more than throw him. Let's see if LSU has some type of offset versus that.
Third and 10. Five wides.
LSU called timeout.
That's their first. 8 minutes, 36 seconds to go in the opening quarter from the Georgia Dome.
Well, let's look what happened here. LSU called timeout and Les Miles is working his quarterback. He said, it's not your fault. We didn't like the work. So he's telling Ryan Perilou, don't worry about it. That was from the bench. Just keep positive. Good coaching.
Tough to keep your composure when you're used to playing.
Oh, that's for sure.
Can't do a thing about it. Matt Flynn. Third and 10.
Some type of wide receiver screen would be safe.
Blitz. Down the middle, Doucette hit and drop. And it'll be Colt David time, I think. Yes.
I'll tell you, there's no doubting Ryan Perilou's abilities. I mean, his arm strength, his, you know, physical stature, his speed, but he still hasn't obviously learned how to read defenses to the level of Matt Flynn.
Colt David, 23 of 29 for the year. This is from 30 yards away.
And that was a new holder because Matt Flynn is his usual holder, so that worked out well.
It was Ryan Perilou.
So you throw over the middle. Tennessee only rushes four. You got to find that robber, and early Doucette found him.
As Ryan Perilou came off the field, Matt Flynn there to greet him, Jerry.
Yeah, he's going to work him all game. And, you know, Matt, unfortunately for Matt, he's been doing that for a lot of years. He's got a lot of experience. He backed up Jamarcus Russell for four tough years.
Sean Godet will kick off. He's assumed to kick off duties late in the season. First made an appearance in the game against Louisiana Tech. And that's Rogan, Dennis Rogan, number 41, and Lennon Freer, the freshman. So a couple of youngsters back, and this would be Lennon Creer at the one-yard line. Slips and balls down at the 20. And let's take another look at the Tennessee touchdown.
And see how fortunate Eric Ainge was. Watch how he looks to the side to their thing and throws the ball. He actually never sees the guy in front of him, and he gets what could have been an interception and turns it into a touchdown pass. Ern, I'm going to get you ready for basketball next week. Okay?
All righty, okay.
He shot a three from the wing, and he banked it. He's going to feel good about himself.
It leads me right to an early promo. We're going to have Indiana-Kentucky basketball next Saturday. Billy Packer is revved and ready. First down and 10. Arian Foster, the running back. 7-3, Tennessee. Here's the handoff to Foster. Bounces it to the outside. Craig Stelz cannot make the tackle until he reaches down and grabs the back foot, the trailing foot. 12-yard gain.
Such a valuable player, you know, because he reads it. This was designed again to go to the left. By the way, that is the seventh straight play Tennessee has run to the left towards Glenn Dorsey. So they're testing him early to see if he's the Glenn Dorsey of the first half of the season or the Glenn Dorsey of the second half of the season.
First down and 10. Play fake. Ainge looking left. Pumps once. Then nobody open deep, so he throws it away.
It was just a two-man pass pattern that time. And again, if you're not going to, you're going to send two guys out, you avoid the sack.
Well, Dorsey chopped at the knee in the Auburn game. Hampered by the bad knee, and then that evolved into back spasms. Although we are told now by his coach that it's a contusion that's giving him problems. Second down and 10. This is Foster. That's Luke Sanders. Now let's go to Tim Brando for the Home Depot update.
All right, Vern, Gary, the ACC championship game. Sean Glennon is going to go 24 yards to Eddie Royal to give Virginia Tech the lead. Now it's 23-16, 20-plus seconds remaining. BC does have the ball with no timeouts left. By the way, Virginia Tech, one of those two-loss teams that would have a case if Missouri and West Virginia both lost. They're actually ahead of LSU in the BCS standings, though LSU beat them by 41, Vern.
Okay, Tim, I thought I was going to hear you try and unravel that in 7 seconds. Here's Ames, the blitz coming from Highsmith. It's incomplete. Fourth and nine.
Highsmith comes, Jones comes, everybody came on that one. Three men, Pelini said, we'll go man-to-man and we'll blitz. And there's still a lot of LSU fans that are wishing that would have happened on fourth and 10, aren't they?
Fourth and 10.
Against Arkansas.
Arkansas had the ball in overtime, and they sent Peyton Hillis into the flat. Danny McCray was late getting there. They did not blitz. And it was a conversion on fourth down, and they wound up winning the game. Britton Colquitt on to punt. Chad Jones, number three, awaits it. Good pressure applied by LSU, and Jones will let this one bounce. And it stopped at the 29-yard line. 39-yard punt, nothing on the return. The CBS Sports Store is the perfect place to find gifts for all the sports fans in your life. Beat the crowds and save big when you shop online at cbssportsstore.com. Ryan Perilou, one of three in his first possession. We mentioned the fact that he hasn't thrown a pass or completed a pass in almost half the season.
Well, and the problem for LSU is they've got five game-breaking receivers, so they have to throw the ball some.
Hester, driven back by Gerard Mayo with help from Eric Berry.
I can guarantee you John Chavis, Tennessee's defensive coordinator, is going to continue to move up and see if LSU is willing to throw the ball with Ryan Perilou. Until they show it, he's going to say, guys, let's sell out to stop the run.
Demetrius Byrd goes wide to the right side. Doucette in the slot. And before the direct snap, there is a flag thrown.
Yeah, Carnell Stewart flinched. Tennessee jumps into the bear look, and Stewart flinched on the play. It'll be a 5-yard penalty against LSU.
False start. 71. Offense. 5-yard penalty.
No, check it out.
Tennessee defense this season in the SEC. You see, they've got some modest numbers, don't they?
Well, in their three losses, they gave up 1,500 yards. Now, it was, you know, some pretty good football.
Right.
Teams, but 1,500 yards in three losses.
They lost to Cal. We saw them lose at Florida. And they lost at Alabama. Here's Keelan Williams coming to the right side, but it was what Philip Fulmer referred to as a Sunday night prayer meeting, complete with podiums being slapped after that loss at Alabama. They've won five in a row to earn the right to get into this game.
And the other thing he said, I think is right on. I've been on some of those teams. You know, everybody was talking and leading and telling everybody what they wanted to do, and not enough guys were going to work and doing it. And finally, they just said, let's go to work and doing it, do it. And they're in spurts playing much better defense. They're still vulnerable, though.
Third and one. That's Dixon, who started in motion. They hand it off. Hester, he's a pretty good option, isn't he?
Yep.
Number 18, the senior from Shreveport.
This play was designed to go to LSU's left. He feels the cutback, runs behind the block. I think it was Herman Johnson's block, might have been Carnell Stewart's block, number 71, but you've got one of those guys, and that's exactly what Gary Croton says about him. He can feel and see those blocks, and he makes up those yards.
First down and 10, Jacob Hester, and timeout is called. By LSU. It comes with 5:17 to go, first quarter. And it's time now for the Home Depot Tools for Success. Tonight, the Lund Sons. This is a vote for all three, from all three of us.
Tracy Wolfson, Gary Danielson, and Vern Lundquist. You got top billing, but this guy may get top billing in college football. He's our player of the year in the SEC, no doubt about it.
I've heard of him.
Yeah.
Pretty good player.
Pretty much done it all.
And the Warrior Award.
No doubt about this one, right, Vern? I mean, we saw that terrible block, and he come out and finished the season. Throwback Award, how about this guy? You like him, don't you? He's the way they played football in the SEC for 75 years.
He could be wearing a leather helmet.
And there's no doubt about this one. You got to love what Sylvester Croom has done this year at Mississippi State, turning that program around. And then our Survivor Island guy of the year, Philip Fulmer. Everybody had him dead. He's not dead, and he's leading 7-3 in this football game.
Well, our colleague Tony Barnhart said of Fulmer, he was at the South Carolina-Tennessee game. Here's Perilou with a pitch. Right side, Keelan Williams. He's a speedster. First down at the 27-yard line. That's a gain of 28.
Well, you can see the game plan unfolding for LSU. It's Jacob Hester up between the tackles, and that it's the option. They put the speed of Keelan Williams in there. Get the guy to block you right there. If you're the quarterback, you get that defensive end to take you, and then Keelan can just slash it up there and make those big, big runs.
Charles Scott now comes in at running back. Hester lines up in a wing to the left side. The fullback tailback, and they do not throw it to him. It's Scott. He's got a blocker in front, and he's got yardage to the 11-yard line.
Scott is his change of pace back, and Scott comes in there. He's a very good receiver, and again, I think it's a good call because, again, it takes the pressure off Ryan Perilou and do what he does best, big Herman Johnson. Mayo says, you know, I made 19 tackles last week, but I didn't see any big 79s on the field.
Oh, he makes the ground tilt. First down and 10, 4:40 to go, opening quarter. Perilou with a change. It's Hester, left side. Inside the 10, tackle made by Gerard Mayo.
A little different offense that LSU is featuring today. It seems that, you know, Tennessee said, all right, we're going to get the running game. But the option, even though I'm sure they're ready for it, has given them a little bit of problems and opened up this football game. Now you can run the option from this thing, too.
Tight end Richard Dixon comes to the left side, the short side of the field.
It's a
blitz. Here's the option. The pitch back to Hester. Loses it. It's out of bounds. It will be LSU ball. And it will be third down and a bunch.
Call this the Pistol Pete shotgun right here for LSU, and Pistol Pete Maravich, my favorite basketball player. Come down, pitch it. Pitch was just a little bit too far in front of Jacob Hester on that play.
And so third and 12, 7-3, Tennessee scored on the opening possession of the football game. Matt Flynn out with a shoulder injury. Ryan Perilou getting only his second start of the season. That's Brett Helms, the junior center, who looks back at him. Number 74. Perilou with a keeper. Doucette tries to provide a block. Tackled way short of the first down. And it's going to be Colt David time. This was Elix Wilson, number 35, who made the stop.
I don't think there's any doubt that LSU here did not want Ryan Perilou to throw an interception here. They said, let's not let him fail early in this football game. It's still a long game. We know how long these games go. Let's let him run. We'll take 3 points, 7-6 game, and our quarterback keeps his confidence.
Ryan Perilou is the holder in place of Matt Flynn, and we've got a substitution problem now as Dixon was late getting off the field.
Fraction on the offense. 5-yard penalty remains. Fourth out.
Yeah, breaking the huddle with 12 men. Even if you get out off the field, if you count wrong, you've got the wrong number of players. Dixon runs off, doesn't matter. 12 men break the huddle, you're going to get called.
So back on five.
Shouldn't be a factor. It should not be a factor.
You'd hope not.
Right. I mean, you know, this guy can kick it from 55.
From 30, Colt David, the junior from Grapevine, Texas. He's 2 for 2 in this game, and that cuts the margin to 1 with 3 minutes and 7 seconds remaining in the first quarter. Perilou is going to get a rest. Eric Ainge is on the field when we return.
Weeks off, aren't they?
Yeah. You want to join me in Bloomington next week?
3 or 4 days off.
Yeah, I'm sure you can get home and change the clothes. Sean Gaudet will kick off now. 9 plays, 58 yards, 3:57 on the clock. And the deep men are Rogan and Lennon Creer. Seven-six, Tennessee. This will be Creer at the 8. He's got a lot of room. Going left, they've got an angle on him and they bring him down. But he is all the way to the 42-yard line. His previous long kickoff return was 32 yards. Jai Eugene saved the touchdown.
Well, Creer is the speed back, a tailback for this Tennessee football team, and shifts the ball nicely. Nice play there, so he could straight arm. But Josh Jean is a fast cornerback for LSU, and he makes a touchdown saving tackle.
Second special teams mistake now for LSU on a kickoff. Remember the opening kickoff of the game, out of bounds, and it was taken over by Tennessee. They went down to score. This one doesn't get anything as they try the right side. Well, earlier today, Les Miles called a press conference to insist that he has reached an agreement in principle with LSU. He will not be a candidate for the Michigan job. It's been really a crazy day.
Well, it has. And you know, Les has tried to walk this tightrope all year because, you know, it's out there. It's his alma mater. Michigan's right out there. And it came to a head today when it was starting to be announced. And he knows his players are watching, you know, ESPN. They're watching it beforehand at game days on there. And they're going with the story. He had to address it with his team. So then he addressed it with everyone.
Foster caught and dropped. Yeah, Les telling Tracy before the game began that a contract has been agreed upon in principle, not signed. This place was chaotic.
It was. The 3-4 hours before the game today was unbelievable.
Third and 10. We haven't even talked about the Bo Pelini situation yet. Supposedly named the new head coach at Nebraska. Third down and 10. Ainge out of the gun. Blitz coming. Ainge, nice job of getting rid of it. Stelz with a fine tackle on Austin Rogers, number 21. And it'll be four down.
Well, you can see Bo Pelini. The rumors are he's going to be the next head coach at Nebraska. You can see he has a resume that includes Nebraska and a lot of Big 12 experience. He's paid his dues, and he's performed well, I think, at LSU and built a good 3-year defense here.
Tom Osborne, the interim athletic director and former great coach, of course, made a trip into Baton Rouge last Sunday and talked with Pelini. Here's the punt. Chad Jones is deep. Colquitt's punt out of bounds. Well, we are seeing Ryan Perilou as a backup quarterback in this SEC championship game. In 2001, Matt Mock came off the bench to replace an injured Rohan Davey and rushed for 2 second-half touchdowns. He led the Tigers to a 31-20 victory over Tennessee, winning the game's MVP honors in the process. Still, I think the most devastating loss in the last 10 years for the Volunteers. They were perfectly in position to win that game. They had defeated Florida in Florida. They were destined to play Miami for the national championship, but they had to get by LSU and they couldn't. First and 10. Williams getting a lot of action here in the first quarter.
One of the things that it appears to me that LSU is doing a good job in managing Ryan Perilou is Les is a very emotional guy, but he has calmed himself down and he's worked Ryan Perilou each time he's come to the sideline to make sure that Ryan knows I've got your confidence. I got your back. We're going to do it. Don't worry about it. Everything's working fine. And so far, it looks like this first quarter he's going to get through, and Ryan Parallels held his own.
From the backside comes the pressure, and Parallel goes right, picks up the first down.
He got rocked on that one.
How's he done early? Take a look. High with that one.
And he's been a little misread a couple plays. There's been some, and there's been some easy dump offs. They've managed the game well with Ryan Parallel, and Tennessee knows that it's sooner or later, though, he's going to go deep. Demetrius Byrd or one of these guys are going to get a deep ball because Parallel has a big arm.
On first down, here's Parallel. Fires it complete after the 35. That's Richard Dixon. Take a look, Gary, at him going down very hard and look and getting up limping.
No doubt about it. On this option play, he got rocked. You could see it as he got hit. He got spun very hard, and he came up limping, maybe his right ankle, right knee. And he got up, and he took a shot. You could see it and recognize it. Yeah, right in the thigh. Right thigh, it looked like. Now, I could transfer anywhere, but it looked like he took the shot right on the thigh.
Limping as he heads to the sideline. Time call because we have reached the end of the first quarter with our score, Tennessee 7. LSU 6. The backup, by the way, is Andrew Hatch. We'll return after this message and a word from your local station. The Smokey is like those cheerleaders that do push-ups for every point,
exactly.
Right? Yeah.
Right now he's telling them the quarterback's hurt, blitz. And they're gonna.
Quick flip, Parallel. Out on the left side, Brandon LaFell with a first down for LSU. And Ryan Parallel limping a little bit.
Yeah, and see, that's what's important as he took this hit from Eric Berry, either on the right thigh, left ankle, I don't know, but it affected his legs. But when you have those weapons at wide receiver, you got to use them. I mean, you just have to use them. LSU's offense will not be able to move the ball against Tennessee all day if they don't use their wide receiving weapons.
We've got Hester in the running in the backfield. Keith Singer steps off the line and looks back. Here's Parallel on first down and 10, second play of the second quarter. Drills it. It's tipped and incomplete. Xavier Mitchell got that one. Well, Gary, assess Ryan Parallel's play so far.
Okay. I think about what the coaches were hoping for. He didn't get him beat early in the football game, and they're assuming he'll get better as the game goes along.
Right.
If I'm Tennessee, though, I'm feeling good about my position in this football game right now. You know, they've got a quarterback, Nick. Their defense has been in a lot of plays. They're batting down passes. If I was Tennessee also, I'd be beware of the deep ball because it is coming. You get a pass knocked down, they're going to go deep.
If you are a believer in omens, you're believing that Tennessee will win this one after that graphic. Here's the pass to Doucette out of the right side, and Doucette slips and is down. That'll be a gain of 6. Let's check in with Tracy Wolfson.
Thanks, guys. I spoke to Brett Bankston, LSU's orthopedic surgeon, about Parallel, and he told me it's a bruised knee. They are saying it's no big deal, but they will look at him further when he comes back to the bench after this drive. Andrew Hatch was warming up, so most likely you'll see him before Flynn.
And practice snaps were shared this week. Parallel got 60%. Hatch got 40%.
Third down and 5. Tennessee with 3 down. They bring 4. Parallel with time. Dixon, the tight end, has a first down and 4 more yards.
Well, Ryan Carl had coverage on this play and just kind of got outrun on this one, coming clear across the formation. I think this is Dixon right here coming clear across, and let's see where Ryan Carl picks him up. About halfway, and then kind of gets bumped by the umpire. Did you see that? That play is designed like that. The tight end crosses right by the umpire, and you hope that the defender gets bumped. It's a great run.
Parallel high with his first 2 passes. He's now 6 of 9 for 74 yards. First down and 10. Here's the toss. Diving try defensively was missed, and Hester gets a couple of yards. Well, Matt Flynn is the starter. He is in his first year as a starter, and there's Carl coming off of an apparent injury. Matt Flynn unable to go today. We think Perilou, the backup. Andrew Hatch is the third string quarterback who started his career at Harvard and was on a mission to Chile. Gary Croton told us the first game we did with these guys, think about my quarterback situation in August. I had a guy who had started one game. I had a backup who had taken seven snaps. And I had a third stringer who was on a Chilean mission last year.
Knocking on doors.
Yes. Hester stopped. It'll be third down.
Tennessee's getting a lot of third down opportunities with good defense right here. LSU is already at their sixth third down opportunity. Now they've done a little of everything. They've run Hester from the fullback spot, they've run the option, and they've thrown the ball. So if you're Chavis, what do? Do you come after Perilou or not?
Already third down and eight. They stunt defensively, little screen pass, right side, Hester gets a block. Hester to the 30-yard line, that will be close. He's just short of the 30, and you just know that Les Miles, if they don't get it, is gonna say, well, we've done this before.
That's for sure. You know, again, another call to protect the quarterback. Third and long, you don't give him something he's gonna make a mistake at, you give him something and he gets it out of his hands, and you take your chances on the screen play.
Louisiana State famously 5 of 5 on fourth downs in their win over Florida. Equally famously stopped short on fourth and two in a triple overtime loss at Kentucky.
They're going to have to burn a timeout here.
They sure are because the play clock is at six and they're getting ready to go for it on fourth and one here. Louisiana State with 11:24 to go has used its last timeout. Fourth down for LSU against Florida, no problem. On the first, Perilou in. Matt Flynn, Demetrius Byrd, and then the most well-remembered of them all, Hester for one, Hester for another. And Louisiana State prevailed 28-24 in that game.
Remember, the option is alive. Does Tennessee play wide gaps and protect for the option, or do they pinch?
Sean Jordan leads the way for Hester. He is hit behind the line, and he is stopped. Eric Berry, number 14.
You play the percentages. Tennessee went wide gaps and blitzed up the middle. They were ready. Watch Tennessee fill inside with the linebackers and the defensive line takes outside shoulders. That was a great call. That's what I suspected with the option. They blitzed inside and had their defensive line play outside shoulder heavy. Chavis guessed right.
Hester now 9 for 46. Here's a play fake. Ainge into the flat, dropped by Austin Rogers. In that narrow win over Kentucky, this Tennessee team dropped six passes, one of which went through the hands in that game of Austin Rogers. John Chavis on the fourth down play.
Well, I'll tell you, this team was rocked for a lot of plays, and Chavis said that I guess.
Second down and 10. Ainge back across the middle.
All right, Vern. Lost by the Bruins.
Them right, and there's just nothing to push with on double teams and
running back for Tennessee on first down. This is Lennon Creer, number 3, listed on the depth chart as the third teamer. He gets the draw play, comes left, tries to, oh, I think if he'd have kept it straight up the middle, he might have gotten a couple more. Well, let's get some more on.
As I spoke to the LSU trainers before the anti-inflammatories and
sealed with that Auburn.
Second down. Ain. And they stop him.
Double teams didn't block him. Single. Just could not get off. Number 72.
Third. Side, high, incomplete, uncatchable. So there was contact with Chad Jones, but
One thing Bo Pelini said about defending Tennessee is we must take away the short passes from Ainge. That's how he keeps from being sacked. We're going to play more man, and we're going to force him to throw the ball downfield.
Britton Colquitt on to punt again, and Chad Jones is back at the 10-yard line.
LSU came close last time to blocking it. Let's see if they can this time.
Nope, not this time. And a fair catch called by Chad Jones. He runs up, grabs it at the 16-yard line. Dorsey limps off. Ainge is playing. Matt Flynn is not. CBS Sports coverage of the SEC Championship will continue after this word from your local station. Now it's time for the playbook presented by the Hartford and the Lund Sons Award, Tracy, Gary, and myself. How about the fourth downs?
Well, this Florida game and these two fourth downs by Jacob Hestey was hit behind the line of scrimmage in both plays and made it and then makes a touchdown afterward. That was a game we'll all remember. Best move, Mark Richt. How about this? He rekindled that Florida-Georgia rivalry. I've got my ticket already punched for next year to watch that one. And then how about this ice water burn? You loved this one, didn't you?
Well, Wes Byram had to kick a game winner, but it was called back. It was good. Urban Meyer called timeout. He had to do it again.
There's been so many moments this year, but those were three of the best.
Here's Perilou with a handoff to Hester. Nice job defensively by Gerard Mayo. JT Mapu was also up there. We mentioned Andrew Hatch's Mormon mission. JT Mapu is back after having spent a couple
Mayo
years.
Has made 35 tackles in the last two football games. He gives credit to those defensive linemen. He says they're keeping me clean. And he was clean on that one, wasn't he? And he comes up and makes the tackle.
I like Mapu's style. He comes in late and gets all the camera.
There he goes.
Yeah. Second down and 8.
There it is, a shift again to the bear. Now LSU should be aware of this. Tennessee's been doing this for 10 years. Late shift into the bear look where you sink your tackles down.
Tom Ritter.
Dead ball. False start. 79. Offense. 5-yard penalty remains. Second down.
I've only been here 2 years.
Right.
I've watched Tennessee from afar, picked them a few games, you know, Miami here, Florida State there. But I've seen them do this forever. They shift into the bare front where they bring their ends and tackles in. LSU must have been made aware of that, and that's 2 false starts.
And 4 penalties for the most penalized team in the SEC. Here's Perilou. Gerard Mayo had just a brilliant game in that 4 overtime victory against Kentucky with 19 tackles last week.
Well, you know, we talked to Coach Chavis and he said, you know, they officially had to play 110 plays, but if you count penalties and do-overs, our guys actually played 119 plays, and two of our safeties, Eric Berry and Jonathan Hefty, played all 119. I'm sure Mayo was in for most of them.
Eight tackles already. It's third and seven. Blitz. Hefty coming. Perilou fires it. Caught. First down. Demetrius Byrd, number two.
And Vern, you called it. He fired it. I thought Brett Vinson thought he had a chance to make this. Good protection as a line, defensive end coming right at him. And watch him throw this ball flat-footed. Vinson says, I got a chance here. And then, zip, that ball goes right by him.
Noise in his ear. There's a flag on the far side of the field. And we'll see.
Could be a sideline warning. Could be too many men on the huddle. See, yep, sideline warning.
Sideline warning on LSU bench. That is their first warning. It's first down.
Talked to the officials before the game about this because there was two of them last week against LSU, and I got clarification that you get two warnings, and the third one is a five-yard penalty.
Somebody needs to get back, coach, to get them back. It's first down and 10. Now Perilou looks over to the side. Keenan Williams trying to get outside, slips the tackle of Eric Berry, but then Berry gets up, and now the chase is on. How about the block?
Perilou lays out Robert Ayers, I believe, but it's still a positive play for Tennessee, and they are beginning to be a force on the defensive line. Berry misses him once, misses him twice, and watch Perilou get Robert Ayers right there up high.
Perilou will get bragging rights on that play, but it was still Tennessee that forced the tackle, Xavier Mitchell, all the way back at the 16-yard line.
Absolutely, and Tennessee has to be disciplined to think about that. Forget about the knockout block. Think about them losing 12 yards.
Officially, we'll make it 14 and call it second and 24. Here comes the blitz from the left side. They got it.
Fumbled. Yep.
Third down. LSU recovers. They have lost, as we said, only two fumbles all year. One of them lost by that man in the Middle Tennessee State game.
Nevin McKenzie right there is the guy coming out. Three-man line, but they rushed four. Miss block that time from the outside for the offense.
Scott.
It was Charles Scott. And Ryan Perilou, he was not hot on the play. He didn't do anything wrong. Scott misses the block on a defensive back. An almost disaster.
What do you got in your pocket for third and 32?
Something that gives you a punt afterwards.
Delay. Flag thrown. This will be a pre-snap penalty. And in all likelihood will cost LSU an additional 5 yards.
Well, Tennessee's got a drive going here now.
Yeah, they do. You're right.
It's the best they've nuked it since the opening drive.
Oh, the snap. Delay of game. Number 11 on the offense. Half the distance to the goal. Delay of third down.
Oh, to be the underdog sometimes, huh? Have everybody talking. LSU's talking about we should still maybe be number one if we win this game. And old Tennessee, they just go to work every day in practice, sneak into this football game and say, we're here.
And as a result of their presence, LSU has a third and 35. Three down. And here comes McKenzie again. He got to him behind the line of scrimmage. That will go as another sack. Well, as a running play. Nevin McKenzie, the junior from San Antonio, Texas.
See, there's just no way they're going to let Ryan Perilou throw the ball into their own end zone. They'll just take their chance punting it. But that was a disastrous series for LSU. I mean, what have they lost, 30 yards or 25 yards?
Right. This is LSU's first punt from the end zone, Patrick Fisher.
Oh, my goodness. What a punt.
Rogan is back and takes it at the 38-yard line. Man, oh, man.
See, that's why the strategy of protecting your backup quarterback works.
Patrick Fisher, who for the year is averaging just under 44, knocks this one 58 yards out. But Tennessee is not too displeased, and neither right now is Les Miles. As we went to commercial, that's Matt Flynn on the left with a one-way conversation.
I was a backup, and I had a young player under me, Bernie Kosar, and you have to be very difficult not to give the quarterback, a young quarterback, too much information. Matt Flynn should pick his spots. Give him some air. Give him some breathing room.
Tennessee, after that 58-yard punt by Fisher, has a first down at the 45-yard line. They lead it by one. There's a play fake, and Ainge comes near side. Chevis Jackson had both hands on it. Can't come up with his fifth interception of the season, but he does knock it down. It was intended for Kenny O'Neill, seldom used wide receiver.
Well, Jackson's probably the more adept of the two defensive backs. We've seen Jackson all year. Actually, we've seen him drop about three or four interceptions.
Sure have.
He should have three or four more.
Second down and 10. Tennessee scored on its first drive of the ball game. Two LSU field goals. Here's Ainge, flips it out left side. And that's dropped by Foster. Well, it's time now. Somebody get the duck walking in.
Affleck.
For the Affleck trivia question of the week. Here it is. LSU, one of four teams who've lost twice in the same season when ranked number one in the AP poll. Remember, they lost at Kentucky, triple overtime when they were number one. They lost against Arkansas when they were number one. There have been three other teams.
Glenn Dorsey not in there. I actually think this is a good move. I wish they would have used it last week. He's not a pass rush guy now. Pelini goes to a three-man front.
Third down, 10. Ainge back. Little pressure, and it's incomplete up at the 50-yard line intended for Foster. There was pressure coming from the backside. Foster can't hang on. It'll be fourth down.
See, that is, you start out first drive. Remember those stats on his first drive, 80%?
Right.
Looks like now LSU is zeroed in now on what Tennessee's going to try to do. They're going to have to come up with something different.
57 yards on that opening drive, Gary, when they got the touchdown in the subsequent four drives, a total of 37 yards.
Very obvious.
Cole Quitt is on to punt. Chad Jones moves up to the 15 here. Oh, what a nice high punt. Way up in the air. Fair catch. Call by Chad Jones at the 10-yard line. The latest of the kicking Cole Quitt family. 45 yards on this one. Nothing on the return. This is the SEC Championship. We're in the Georgia Dome, Tim. 4:28 to go in the first half of play. Tuesday on CBS, catch Heidi Klum and all the Victoria's Secret fashion models plus musical surprises in the all-new Victoria's Secret Fashion Show, Tuesday at 10, 9 Central on CBS. Matt Flynn, the quarterback out with a shoulder injury, has given way to Ryan Perilou. Perilou on first down, play fake, looks deep. He's got Doucette way down there. Can he find him? No.
Well, they waited until they had a first down play to air it out and try to back off that secondary from Tennessee that has been there. You're going to see in the middle right here. It's going to be right down the middle right there. Early Doucette. Had a chance. Ball was slightly overthrown. Perilou could have made a good throw and connected there. It was not now. Problem with throwing deep on first down. We've all been there. Second long.
Well, not all of us have been there.
Well, it's no fun. Second and long.
Never experienced that.
Trindon Holiday in the game.
Yes, indeed. Number eight. They hand it off to Hester. He gets into the secondary. First down, Jacob Hester.
Wow, what a brilliant call. What a brilliant call. Now remember last week, Vern, I circled Hester three times when he went to fullback and they threw the ball to him. LSU must have self-scouted or watched our rebroadcast of the game. Because if I know it's coming, they got to figure the other team knows it's coming, and they now have run Hester at fullback each time and put Trindon Holiday as a decoy.
Hester on the ground, 11 carries, 62 yards. Gary Croton, who former head coach at Brigham Young and Louisiana Tech in his first year as the offensive coordinator here. Hester again at left tackle. Now, one of the key plays, Gary, in that game, everybody, I think, is going to remember 4th and 10 when Arkansas converted. But with the score tied 21-all and Hester lined up as the fullback, they found him deep on the wheel route for a touchdown. Call back because Early Doucette had lined up illegally. And then Arkansas went and scored. Quinn Johnson and Richard Murphy are the two in the backfield now. Second down and 4. Option, pitch, Murphy comes right, not much there. DeMonte Bolden, number 98, makes the contact and it'll be third down. Well, we're a little over 3 minutes away from the Dr. Pepper Go For More event. They've tweaked the little halftime. Yeah, we've tweaked it. And it'll be fun. $1 million is still the potential payoff. 3rd and 5. Three down for Tennessee. They're going to bring the blitz. Perilou, he's got him. It's Bird to the 50-yard line.
I'll tell you, that Perilou has some talent. When he finds his way as a quarterback and takes all the snaps, you're going to find this guy has got, as advertised, the blitz is coming right here. But Tennessee is going to play zone. It's a zone blitz, and if you don't get him in a zone blitz, there's only 6 guys back there, and that means there's a lot of space to throw the football.
Gain of 23, 2:25 to go before the halftime break. Bird again spins to the outside and is driven out of bounds. There is a player down at the 50-yard line for Tennessee, and a flag is down as well. JT Mapu.
On offense, 5-yard penalty, replay, first down.
And so 5 yards against Louisiana State. We've got 2:18 remaining in the first half. Tennessee took the opening kickoff and marched 57 yards, got the touchdown to go up 7-0. Ryan Perilou has gone the distance at quarterback for Louisiana State. Matt Flynn out with a shoulder injury, the senior. So Perilou, the sophomore, getting his second start of the season. This a little larger stage. This is Tennessee in the SEC. His last start was Middle Tennessee State. He was brilliant in that game, and he's been fine tonight.
Another penalty.
Wow. They are the most penalized team in the SEC.
And the ones that kill you, those pre-snap penalties.
False start. 65. Offense, 5-yard penalty, remains first down.
Remember, they hit a pass play for a first down, a big play, and they get 2 penalties. One illegal formation, and now legal movement up front. Lyle Height, number 65 right there, moves inside instead of 1st and 10. They're back to 1st and 20.
Look at that. Tennessee, no blemishes.
Right. No timeouts, by the way, for LSU.
They use their last with 11 minutes to go in the second quarter. 1st and 20. Again, 3 down for the Volunteers, and they will bring 4. Perilou out of the backfield finds Murphy. He gets a fine block from Brandon LaFell, and they get 12 back. Xavier Mitchell goes back to make the tackle.
Boy, is Ryan Perilou finding his sea legs or what? The strategy has worked perfectly for LSU. Start him off slow, run some options. Once he gets the feel of the football game, turn him loose to throw the ball a little bit.
Well, he's now 10 of 14 for 126 yards. Second and 8. McKenzie coming from the corner. Perilou out to Murphy in the right flat. That'll bring up third and 5 or 6, depending on the spot. Wes Brown, number 94, makes the tackle here.
We did the Florida game with Tennessee in that football game when Florida put 50 on him, I guess, whatever it was. And I watched some tape of the Cal game before preparing for that game. This is an improved defense. I mean, their secondary is so much better than the secondary I saw early in the season. You can see they're learning how to play their zone coverages.
John Chavis, longtime defensive coordinator, 3rd and 6. Again, 3. They bring 4. And Bird makes the catch. Wow!
You talk about a rocket throw here. I mean, this is the receivers are going to have to adjust to a fastball here. Vincent peeks in. When he peeked in, Bird stuck that arm out, and he caught it, didn't he?
Yeah, I think so. I'm sure they'll take a look at it. It might go under review, but it sure looked like he had possession.
He caught it. I could save you some time right now.
Replay official tonight is Ben Oldham, and Perilou, my gosh.
He has spectacular talents.
So Tom Ritter will get the headset. I'm guessing this won't take terribly long. Look at that catch.
Yep, it's got a break for both teams here. Tennessee's defense is reeling with these first downs, and LSU has no timeout, so they both can go to the sideline and take advantage of a replay. Yeah, he cradled that one, I believe.
Demetrius Bird, junior college transfer in his first year at LSU.
The future looks bright for LSU. Tennessee has very few seniors playing for them. Boy, SEC is a good
after review. The ruling on the field is confirmed. It was a catch. First down.
Nice play done by Demetrius Bird. He had a touchdown catch in the game against Arkansas, and he was the intended receiver on the try for two that was intercepted by Matero Richardson, and that was the final play of that LSU-Arkansas game. First down and 10. 54 seconds to go. Clock running again. Left side, Doucette. He's got big Saron Black in front. And I do mean big Saron Black. That's to the 10-yard line. A first down. The clock in college football will stop when they move the chain on a first and 10.
Doucette is so smart here. He sets up the blockers. Watch, it's a screen, but he sets them up by going inside and then reading the block outside. Instead of cutting back, Doucette, who played quarterback in high school, read it and took advantage of it.
And now the ball spiked. And so the clock stops with 38 seconds to go.
That means they'll have 2 quick shots to the end zone and still have time for a field goal.
Well, while they set up, it's time now to bring on the duck again. And the answer to the trivia question, 1 of 4 teams who've lost twice in the same season. The answers are Minnesota in 60, Nebraska in 84, Notre Dame in 90. Second down and 10.
I don't like that one. Don't like that one at all.
He's in jail. Now they've got to really hustle. 30 seconds to go.
They either are going to call a play here to the end zone, or they're going to ground it. With a veteran quarterback, you could throw to the end zone. But I think right now they're just going to spike the ball and get a field goal try.
17 seconds to go.
You could throw a fade. You could throw a fade.
Sense of urgency with the crowd, and the clock winding down.
They'll add seconds. They'll add seconds. This is another break for LSU. Remember, the cutoff is 9 seconds. They think they can throw a fade if there's 9 or more seconds to go.
They did against
Auburn. Please reset the game clock to 12 seconds.
Plenty of time to throw to Bird in the corner.
Remember, they won the game against Auburn on a catch with I guess 3 seconds was left on the clock, but the clock was actually stopped with one. And so 12 seconds to go. Now 11. There's the spike.
Now see, young quarterback. I mean, if you have a veteran quarterback there, you're going to throw that fade to the corner and still be able to kick the field goal.
So for the third time in the first half, it's the all-time leading single season scorer for LSU, Colt David. He's 2 of 2 so far, both from 30. And Perilou will hold. This is from 31 out. Jacob O'Hare is the deep snapper.
Timeout, Tennessee.
So time called with 10 seconds remaining. 7-6 Volunteers. Thursday on CBS, an investigator's life spirals out of control on a powerful new episode of CSI, Thursday at 9, 8 Central on CBS. Now they've changed the official yardage on this one. It's a 30-yarder. Perilou will hold it. The snap a little high. The kick is, whoa! Wide right!
When you upset a team, some things have to go your way. Let's see if the hold was good. Appears it was good. Tilted towards the holder. That's what you want to do so it doesn't hook, and it never did.
Colt David misses from wide right on a 30-yarder in their 5-game win streak. You see, Philip Fulmer, it's gone his way. Recall that Ryan Succop of South Carolina missed one. And in the Vandy game, Honfelt had one graze the left upright. So they've gotten some breaks from missed field goals. Who knows how important this one will be?
Well, the defense played 46 plays. They played 110 last week, but they've survived the first half.
Let's go down to Tracy, who is with Les Miles.
Thanks a lot, guys. Coach, how would you assess Perilou's first half performance?
Good. He throwing the football well. He's making the checks. You know, we have to manage the. We are down in the short field. You know, backed up. We got to manage that better as coaches. But you know, I think he's given us every opportunity to win.
Would you have made a different decision on that fourth down call if Matt Flynn was in the game?
I don't know. It's probably the same call.
How about the focus of the team? This was the concern. Do you like what you've seen from them?
Yeah, I like how we're playing. This is going to be a second half game. We knew that.
Thanks a lot, Coach.
Now, Philip Fulmer, his team has won 5 in a row to get into this game. They have the lead at the half by 1. Coming up, Dr. Pepper's Go For More event when we return after this message and a word from your local station. Tennessee with the lead at the start of the third quarter. LSU will get the ball. And a moment ago, this was Ryan Perilou, who's getting his second start of the season. His head coach, Les Miles, little words of encouragement. And a very good first half for Perilou overall, 14 of 18. Only went deep, as I can remember, a couple of times.
One time overthrew it to Doucette, maybe twice, you're right. And very well managed. But obviously against Tennessee's defense, they're going to need more.
Colquitt will kick off. Trendon Holiday is on the left as Tennessee comes down the field. And this will be Keelan Williams, who grabs it at the 10-yard line. No, it's Chad Jones who's back. It's Jones, number 3, who replaces Keelan Williams. And so LSU gets it. They have dominated Gary in every way, but they trail by 1.
I think they were 3 times at the 10-yard line or inside the 10-yard line. They came away with 2 field goals. Now, I'm surprised by that a little bit because a running quarterback usually is pretty effective inside the 10-yard line. Not a lot of experience, I guess, but I look, if you're LSU, we're moving the ball, we'll eventually score.
Well, certainly the Les Miles seemed to have a lot of equanimity. He wasn't concerned at all when he was chatting with Tracy, and they went in. First down and 10. Here's the toss. Holiday out to the 29-yard line. Well, I haven't asked you, how do you like the Tennessee uniforms?
Well, I can read them. I mean, that's one advantage. I like when they're in orange. You know, it's funny. Coach Chavis said one of the reasons he feels that Mayo did not get enough tackles as a linebacker is because our road uniforms are hard to read from the press box.
Well, we can testify to that. This is the first time they have worn the all orange since 1999. They look a little bit like moving dreamsicles. Second down and 4. Here's Holiday coming right. And let's take a look at the first half stats presented by Dr. Pepper.
Well, a lot of check marks, not a lot of points. That's my expert analysis on that.
You get paid a lot of money for stuff
right.
Like that.
Check marks are good, points are better.
Third down. Bird and Doucette wide left. Holiday is still in the backfield alongside Ryan Perilou. Matt Flynn not playing with an injured shoulder. Four-man Tennessee rush. Perilou in trouble, pulls up. He's got LaFell way downfield. LaFell has to wait on it, but he makes the catch.
Tell you, watch out for this Ryan Perilou next year. Watch out, college football. This guy's going to be spectacular. LaFell's going to go right down here, but the only reason he's open is because Perilou gets outside of the pocket. You get outside of the pocket, two Tennessee people miss them. The ball's underthrown, but you should underthrow it when you got a guy that wide open.
Jonathan Hefney giving chase. LaFell backing up a 48-yard completion. Perilou, LaFell, they've got the Doucette LaFell shoulder bump down solid. Here's Holiday, and he's down to the 17-yard line.
Because I'll tell you, Perilou now, you know, he's what, 15 for 19? He's over 200 yards throwing already in this football game. Just a few of them downfield, but I go back to being well managed. I mean, when you switch quarterbacks, Les has been very calm. Gary Croton has called a good game plan. They've run the ball just enough, thrown it enough, and he's earning more respect from his offensive coordinator.
Here's a reverse Doucette. Oh. Whoa! Rico McCoy, number 5.
Boy, these guys bend, but they don't break, do they? They are reading these plays. It looked like a play was going, but McCoy is blitzing, and he does not go for the sweep. He sees it all the way. He saw Doucette coming as he was blitzing.
Ten-yard loss, third and 16. LaFell and Terrence Tolliver to the right side. Bird and Doucette to the left. Four-man rush, they come with a corner, and that one's in the end zone, caught, touchdown, Demetrius Bird.
There is no way this play should have worked, but that was a Jamarcus Russell throw to the outside.
Jamarcus Russell now with the Oakland Raiders, last year's starting quarterback. I'm getting an idea of why folks are excited about Perilou. Here's the extra point from Cole David. It's up and good.
Watch how wide the safety was lined up. He was lined up outside the wide hash. Look at this. There is no room to throw that ball in that area. That safety should eat it up. He stands there, a 40-yard throw, and the safety misjudged the throw. That should have been an interception. That's an interception that should have been for Tennessee for a touchdown, an interception for LSU that for a touchdown, both 1-1.
SEC Championship Diamond Moment presented by Kate Jewelers.
In 2001, quarterback Matt Maugh came off the bench to replace an injured Rohan Davey and rushed for 2 second-half touchdowns, leading the Tigers to a 31-20 victory over Tennessee. 2 years later, Justin Vincent ran all over Georgia, rushing for 201 yards and 2 touchdowns. LSU won 34-13 on their way to a share of the national title.
Tennessee took the opening drive of the game and scored a touchdown. LSU, the opening drive of the second half. Touchdown caught by Demetrius Byrd, number 2, off the arm of Ryan Perilou. 7th touchdown catch of the year for Demetrius Byrd. Here's the kick taken at the 7 by Lennon Creer, the freshman. And good special teams. Let's go back to the touchdown toss.
Let's figure out how far this thing was thrown, okay? Ryan Perilou lets this ball go from about the 35-yard line, and he catches it about the 4. So I went to Purdue, and I can draw these triangles up here, okay, like that. And then we got a right angle right here, so we can figure out A squared plus B squared equals C squared. The same angle, I'm going to say it's 37 yards.
You're amazing. You're just amazing.
A squared plus B squared, right angle.
I've got a degree in sociology and history. You think I understand that?
You handle the words, I'll handle the math.
Okay. Oh, gracious. Here's the catch made by the tight end, Brad Cottom. Only the 4th game he's been able to play this year. Broke a wrist in preseason. He is a load at 6'8", 270.
And he's about a 4'7 guy, and he came back last week, caught that play against Georgia.
Kentucky.
Excuse me, Kentucky.
That's all right.
Blue,
here's
Kentucky.
red equals Georgia.
Yes, I got it.
Blue.
Or black. Black would equal Georgia.
There you are. First down and 10.
Well, I screwed that one up. Oh, well.
No. Left side, Foster. Arian Foster bounces off the first tackle, and he's out of bounds at the 44-yard line. Well, 12 top 5 teams lost to unranked teams in this unusual season. 4 different teams have been ranked on the top, and 2 number 1 teams lost at home in November. These LSU Tigers and, of course, the Buckeyes of Ohio State. Ohio State in pretty good shape as they await the results of tonight's game.
No Glenn Dorsey.
Yep, again. Left side, caught. Lucas Taylor.
Well, that was nice by Eric Ainge. You got to be able, in modern-day football, to be able to throw the ball flat-footed. They just don't allow you to stand on pitcher's mound and stride to home plate. As we look at Glenn Dorsey, he just does not have the pop in there. I mean, I the guy's a warrior, but I feel horrible for him. His senior year, I mean, he was having an unbelievable season to start out with.
First down and 10. Ainge, play fake. Being chased, fires it out, incomplete. Good job by Luke Sanders covering. And let's go back to Tim Brando for this Home Depot update.
Vern, in the Civil War at Eugene, we're suddenly tied at 21. 2 touchdowns scored in less than a minute. This is Lyle Moivau that fumbles. Jairus Byrd is going to pick it up and go the other way for a touchdown. So we're tied at 21 at the break. Back to Vern.
Thanks, Tim. I love the Oregon uniforms.
Well, I would have bet against that if I was knowing you.
I was being sardonic.
You got it.
2nd down and 10. Ames, screen pass. Josh Briscoe, number 81. Down to the 35, maybe 36-yard line is where they'll mark it.
Well, it's called a rhythm passing attack. And, you know, a lot of credit goes to the offensive line, but a lot of credit goes to the design of the plays. Eric Ainge has less than 2.5 seconds to get rid of the ball no matter what. Now, that was a screenplay. That's unique. But all year, he's been told, pre-read, throw the ball, or get rid of the ball.
Austin Rogers is the only wideout. Double tight end set on third and one. Foster goes right and has the first down. Arian Foster, over 1,000 yards for the season.
That's the eighth first down of the game for Tennessee. They had four of them on the first drive of the game. On the next four drives, they had one first down, and now they put together three on this drive.
And Gerald Jones, the freshman wide receiver, is in at quarterback. He'll take the direct snap. Option play, Jones keeps it. To the 15-yard line. Craig Stelz with the tackle.
Boy, modern day football. You put together a game plan. You say Eric Ainge is going to be your quarterback, and all of a sudden you got one of these guys that are recruited as a quarterback slash player, and look at all the things you can do from it. It really exposes this LSU defense. Parker gets a great block right there. Anthony Parker, number 75.
Ainge back. Oh, no, Jones is still there. And this time fakes the pass, hands it off to Foster. You're suggesting this is not your father's team formation.
No, and it never will be again, to tell you the truth. I mean, Ainge comes back in. Ollie Highsmith has time. And I continue to say, even though it's risky, you must come after that formation. If you sit back, there's just too many options, and you're too flat-footed and too much space. I think you need to crowd it and go after it.
Eric Ainge, Tennessee with the first down, at the second down, I beg your pardon, second and 10. Foster, Ollie Highsmith.
And also Derry Beckwith on that time too. He forced it into Highsmith. You know, you're plugging the middle inside. Derry Beckwith, when he's healthy. I mean, and no Glenn Dorsey out there right now. So Tennessee, when they runs it, they feel like they can run the ball at the middle of the defense. You know, that's Charles Alexander, hurt early in the year, and now Glenn Dorsey.
There's Highsmith. It's third down and eight.
They're coming after it. If I know, David Cutcliffe knows, I'll tell you that.
Change is made. Play clock at three. And they come. Ainge.
Interference.
Yes.
Interference. Absolutely.
Jevis Jackson, it was intended for Briscoe. It'll be first down. No. Let's see.
Oh, wow. Was there a pre-snap penalty on this?
Here's Tom Ritter.
Oh.
There is no foul for pass interference. The ball was tipped. Ball was tipped.
Didn't see that one.
Let's see if we can see it now.
I think it was Ricky Jean-Francais, number 90. I think it was number 90. Yes, it was. Just took some of the spin off of that, didn't he?
Now, he's an interesting story, Gary. Suspended for a violation of team rules all season long.
Regular season.
Regular
season. The loophole.
Right. That's a, and he is playing for the first time tonight. Field goal. Well, nope. It happens to Tennessee. Daniel Lincoln. Misses wide right. It's a contagious disease. 13-7 still.
Looked like, did the kicker Lincoln get hit on this as he let the ball go or not? But it was pushed wide, just exactly like Colt to us.
Bo Pelini helps with the celebration. ...13-7 LSU leads. Now the SEC moment presented by Sonic.
If I'm not going to send my own children, I'm not going to send my players.
One, two, three, that was the ball.
ball. It's loose. Tigers got it. Tosses the ball. Intercepted. Touchdown! Riggs over left tackle. Touchdown. Touchdown. Touchdown, Tennessee. Instant victory in overtime at Baton Rouge.
Better not ever underestimate the heart of the Volunteers.
Against top 10 teams on the road. What do you need to do to change that?
I'm not worried about 0-2 against top 10 teams on the road. I'm worried about finishing this game and finishing it well. Our football team's damn good. We figure to show that the second half.
How are you going
to
do that?
Play our off.
Inside cut. Go for the touchdown. Williams heading to the corner. Has a chance to score.
He throws. Touchdown! Doucette caught it with 9 seconds left in the game.
And so in the last 2 years, one apiece. And right now, LSU leads it 13-7, 8-12 to go in the third. Hester, little somersault at the end to the 26-yard line. Rico McCoy, number 5, with the tackle.
Well, he's our throwback player of the year. In the Lundsons, right?
Lundsons, yeah.
Lundsons.
It'll get easier as we do it more often. Or is this a one-time only?
I don't know. Can we have this good a year again next year?
Good point.
Now, can the LSU offensive line, they've got the passing game established, can the LSU offensive line pound now?
Charles Scott is in. Here's Perilou rolling out. Nobody open. Pulls up. Now he finds, right to the hands of Keith Singer. Jacob Hester, senior out of Shreveport, Louisiana.
He started off the game the way he's played every game. Finds the cracks, finds the corners, blocks, runs tough, and he doesn't turn the ball over, does he, Vern?
Only one fumble in his career, one lost fumble. That was the first game of his career. That was against Georgia, 2004. This team... collectively, the running backs have not lost a fumble in over 600 carries. Scott and Hester in the backfield. On third down, here's Perilou. Watch out. He lets it go as he is hit, and he's got a first down at the 32. Brandon LaFell.
You're so right in to say watch out, but it's so obvious how quick Perilou can throw the ball. He waits, and then look how quick he can deliver that ball. He has it all. Now, if he learns how to play quarterback, it's going to be scary the next couple of years at LSU because all those receivers, there's only one leaving, Early Doucette.
And Perilou has had some well-documented off-the-field issues, so fair to say he needs to show a little maturity. Here's Trendon Holliday all the way across the 50 and out of bounds.
Well, I'll go back, Vern, to the old way the wishbone was run and the coaching technique used to be. Watch it. Coming down the line of scrimmage at the pitch. It's called outside hip, no dip. And here it is. Outside hip, no dip. Just keep going wide, and it's set up the blocker. That's the old Texas and Oklahoma coaching points.
Emery Ballard put that in when he was the offensive coordinator for Darryl Royal. At the University of Texas, Oklahoma started it. Their first wishbone was in the annual Texas OU game.
Uh-oh.
Picked up by Eric Berry. No, it's not. Yes it
does.
Is Berry.
Yes, he does.
No sooner do we mention no fumbles and 600 carries by the running backs than Trendon Holliday pops it up. Only the third lost fumble of the year.
Well, we're getting you ready for basketball. You give those free throw statistics, and all of a sudden he misses it. And this time, Holliday does it right on cue. Eric Berry, a great athlete, offensive and defensive player in high school, and that ball pops up, and oh my.
Right into his hands. Hoopta.
Toyota presents Heroes of the Fall.
We're hosting South Carolina, and we needed to win to have any shot of winning the division. I mean, that game was really do or die for us. know, we felt like our backs were against the wall. We get out there with no timeouts, get set to kick. We have somebody jump offside. We go on through and kick the ball. And there's flags and the whistles, and I hesitated a little bit. Casey hesitated a little bit. We laughed about it that we had to make it hard on ourselves backing up a little bit more, but fortunately we got another chance. That's what any kicker or competitor dreams about, to have the game on the line and have the game in their hands. Then over time, already had a few opportunities that were longer throughout the game, and you're sitting there thinking, just don't miss. Just go out there and execute. Afterwards, you look back on it and realize how fortunate you are to perform in that setting and play for this school and with these guys here. It makes it all the more worthwhile.
Toyota, moving forward.
Third fumble lost in this season. This one, Trendon Holliday, hit by his own man. And the ball goes over. First fumble in 659 carries by the LSU running backs. Here's a handoff. Arian Foster coming to the near side and being forced out of bounds by Chevis Jackson. Let's go back to Tim Brando in New York.
All right, Vern, UCLA's Patrick Cowan just back from an injury. He's going to hit Dominic Johnson, an 8-yard strike. Look at this catch, huh? Vern, that play moves to top of the list for plays of the year, part two. It's 17-7 Trojans at halftime.
All right, Tim, we saw your plays of the year production. That was well done by the guys in the studio. Lost two on the last play, second down and 12. Ainge, man wide open. My goodness, it's Chris Brown, the tight end. Blown assignment of some sort.
He kind of flooded the area over there. They had a bunch formation to start with, and you know, one guy goes deep, and then Chris Brown just kind of follows him. Deep, and then here's Chris Brown right here following him, kind of a trail route. Right behind Austin Rogers, Chris Brown follows him, and that's exactly what happens. Two guys in the same area, and a wonderful read by Eric Ainge.
24-yard gain, first down and 10, just inside the 45.
Same bunch formation again.
Look at this. 289 completions. A guy named Manning comes to mind. Here's Foster going right. And let's get some injury updates. Here's Tracy.
That's right, guys. The tailbone injury Glenn Dorsey has been dealing with is keeping him sidelined again. He looked extremely frustrated that he can't be in there. He was walking in obvious pain earlier. He is listed out for now. And as for running back Keelan Williams, we haven't seen him in all game because, or all half, because he is out with a knee injury he suffered at the end of the first half.
All right, thank you, Tracy. Second down and 9. Eric Ainge. Back. Got a man open. Briscoe to the 30-yard line. Tennessee moves the chains again.
Boy, wouldn't that be a nice draft pick, maybe beginning of the second round or something for the Indianapolis Colts, because he plays just like Peyton Manning. I mean, Eric Ainge, he's a rhythm thrower. He reads the defenses quickly, gets the ball to the outside, and is very accurate. He is obviously has a bright future.
And the offensive coordinator who teaches him also taught Peyton and Eli, David Cutcliffe. First down and 10, Ainge 13 yards on the last one.
Same bunch formation.
Pumps once, across the middle, caught. Caught him, his second catch of the ball game.
Wow. Now everybody, what I thought was covered on that play, but both Lee shaking his head. I thought everybody was covered. Everybody was covered early, but late, Brad Cottom comes across, and you're taught, if you're a tight end in that middle, try to get in front of the quarterback. Find his eyes. And that's exactly what Cottom did. Sometimes the receiver has to present himself to the quarterback, and he did.
Ainge now 11 of 20 in the ball game on second down. They hand it off. No, they play fake. And he's got a man wide open again to the right. Austin Rogers. First and goal.
Just shows you a lot of different weapons, a quarterback, and here's the last thing. No pressure on Eric Ainge. It looks like he's throwing 7-on-7 out there. Can they get any pressure? In comes a new quarterback.
Jonathan Crompton is in, the running quarterback. High formation. Crompton on the roll. Well read by the LSU defense. Beckwith up high.
And poorly executed by, it was the same play that they got out of early. And this right. time Crompton stumbled coming out from under center.
So one and out for Crompton, who will be the starter next year, we think.
Never know.
Yeah, we think.
There's a little bit of history of freshmen starting at Tennessee, I believe, isn't there?
I've heard that.
Yeah, that's right.
Ainge back in. Eric Ainge, his senior year. Dance is right. Again, no pressure whatsoever. He has to throw it away, however. Good downfield coverage. And recall that this drive began on the Trindon Holiday fumble.
He bumps right into his own man on that time, and ball pops up in the air. And, Trindon Holiday says, I thought I had a clear area, but Charles Scott's rear end was in the way.
Ninth play of the drive after the fumble. There's a player down at the 12-yard line. Tyson Jackson, the defensive end, number 93.
And he's been very quiet in this football game, hasn't he? He has not gotten those quick matchups and got off the edge at all.
Six-five junior, starter at the left defensive end spot. Glenn Dorsey on the bench.
Number of plays. There he is on the right side right here. Number of plays. Foster takes him on, and I don't know if he got his foot caught behind. He starts limping, and you can see he must have sprained his ankle when he engaged with Foster on that play, number 78.
Third and goal.
Well, will LSU bring the blitz and put pressure?
Two wide left, one wide right. It does not appear they're going to come.
Same coverage as last play.
Ainge. Touchdown, Tennessee, Josh Briscoe. Top.
I think I've heard that a few times, but I'll tell you, that was pretty good execution. Danny McCray had decent coverage, but an absolute strike from Eric Ainge.
Daniel Lincoln for the extra point to break the tie and give Tennessee the lead again. They're up 14-13.
Watch McCray over the slot move in and out and in and out. He moves back and forth to try to change it up. In, out, decent coverage. Ball is perfectly thrown to the outside. Ainge zeroes in. He knows it's outside man-to-man. It was the same exact coverage as the one before. And I think Eric Ainge knew exactly where to go. Number 10, after the turnover, says, Coach, I got you one.
Volunteers lead at 14-13. Hello, Smokey. One more? Sure. Oh, gosh. Here's the kick. Chad Jones takes it at the goal line. At the 20. Oh, boys, he popped. My goodness. Looks like Quentin Hancock might have gotten there. Ouch. Hancock down low. LSU trailing again. Davis also a part of it. Dorian Davis, number 34. 3:03 to go, third quarter. Tennessee by one. Carolou caught by Doucette, no game. May have lost a yard. Eric Berry with the tackle. Now Red Lobster presents today's Scholar Athletes. That's Duel. Austin Rogers for Tennessee, finance major, 3.35. And for Louisiana State, Mitt Cole, third string tight end, a major in finance as well with a 3.2 grade point average. Red Lobster's commitment to the investment in our future shown by donating $1,000 to East School's general scholarship fund. Toss to Hester, goes left, third and 10.
I tell you, Gerard Mayo didn't make the tackle on that one, but he went over there and ate up a block and allowed somebody else to make the tackle. Watch number 7. This is good middle linebacker play. He gets there, eats up the block from the fullback, and allows his teammate to make the block.
It was Rico McCoy up high. It's third down and 8. Hester is out. Four-man rush. Carolou rolls out under some pressure. He's got intercepted. Picked off by Eric Berry. Tennessee football at the 37-yard line.
Well, I hate to say, I saw what Ryan Carolou saw. Terrence Tolliver is going to sit down right there for a second, and then he breaks off his route. Just as Carolou's going to throw it. Now watch, there he is. He sits down, and then he breaks off his route, and the safety sees the ball coming. Because there was pressure, yes, but Carolou said, I thought he was going to stay there. LSU fans are saying, what the heck was that? Well, there was a plan there.
Second turnover in the last 5 minutes. Play fake. Here's Ainge. Rolling to his right, nobody open. He's got to throw it away again. Well, they tried to, the old tactic of make a long strike after the turnover, and this one didn't work.
This was a busted play. Lucas Taylor was running a handoff. Watch Taylor come in motion here, and then he doesn't know what to happen. Number 12, I thought he felt he was going to get the handoff for a play-action pass, see? And he goes, what happened? And then that just blew up the play because nobody knew what to do.
Second and 10. Play Foster to the 34-yard line. Al Woods, who's in there in place of Glenn Dorsey, with the tackle. Let's go to Tim Brando for this Heisman watch presented by Nissan.
All right, Vern and Gary, I submit for your approval Chase Daniel on display against Oklahoma in the Big 12 title game. The number one Tigers. Will he be a factor in the Heisman tonight? Could go a long way. The leaders in the clubhouse, arguably out of the SEC. Tebow of Florida, McFadden of Arkansas. Back to you, Vern.
All right, Tim, they are both idle this weekend. Third and 7, Tennessee with a 1-point lead. Right side, Raheem Alem had a little pressure, and there's Stelz to knock it away. No flag.
This drive stopped with the bust on first down. That shifted the strategy of the play. Ball was thrown, and Stelz does a nice job. He took his hand off the back, and he made the play. He has every right. The bust cost him. Lucas Taylor thinks he's getting a handoff. I actually believe that Eric Ainge blew that play.
Do you?
Yes, because everybody else was running a play-action pass, and he was running some kind of a discombobulated pass. I have no idea what was going on there.
Fourth down and 7, and Tennessee calls timeout to chat about it. Another look at Ryan Carolou, Terrence Tolliver. Carolou thought he was going to continue deep, laid it in the hands of Eric Berry. Here's Ryan Perilou on the interception, and an injury occurred on this play, Gary.
Yeah, Perilou, as he threw it, looked like he caught his finger on a helmet or a shoulder pad. And watch at the end of the play, he's going to glance down and notice that he's got a little laceration on his right finger. Everybody knows what a right finger. There it is, right there. You can see the cut on his right finger. And then it was James Bond on the sideline.
51-yard field goal attempt. Long of the year is for 48, and this one is wide right.
That would have made it.
Yes.
And now Perilou, as he comes out, will have that finger taped up.
Here's the Lincoln kick. Or the kick by Lincoln.
Either way, it was no good.
No, that's right. And so the ball comes out to the 35-yard line. Les Miles. And here is Perilou with an injured finger. This was the scene on the sideline.
Boy, come on, Tracy, get in there and see what's going on.
Hester on first down. Let's go down to Tracy Wolfson.
Guys, I was right behind him, but I mean, there were like 10 people surrounding them. There were boards up, there were towels up. They didn't want me to see anything, but Gary, as you mentioned, he had a really bad gash on that right finger. They tried to get it to stop bleeding. That was the problem. So they just taped it up quickly to try and get him back in there. We'll see if he can play through it.
Well, Tennessee fans right now are saying, let's see if we can get one of those fumbled handoffs when Eric had his bad finger. Remember early in the year?
Eric Ainge against Florida with a bad index finger. And it cost him as he tried to hand off left-handed on one particularly memorable play. Fourth quarter. We've reached the end of three. 14-13 Tennessee. We'll return to the Georgia Dome right after this word from your local station. We welcome you back to the Georgia Dome in Atlanta, 14-13, as we start the fourth quarter. Tennessee scored on its opening drive of the game, couple of field goals by LSU, a 7-6 score at the half. And then LSU went up by a score of 13-7 on a touchdown, only to have Tennessee come back and take a lead on a touchdown catch by Josh Briscoe. Here's Ryan Perilou with an injured index finger on his throwing hand, throwing it away. You saw the injury sustained when he was hit after a pass. He's got that index finger heavily wrapped. How much does that affect him?
Well, it has to affect you, or we would all bandage our finger. Can't make it any better. I think.
Walked right into that.
Well, let's be honest here. I don't know if it affects them that much where you have to go to your third string quarterback or not. I think that they will evaluate that right away to see if it's going to affect his throwing, because clearly LSU without throwing the ball is not going to beat Tennessee in this football game.
Matt Flynn has not played it down tonight, out with an injured shoulder. Glenn Dorsey tried to give it a go, but he's got a tailbone contusion, so he's out. And now Perilou may not be able to finish.
And LSU's players have been through so much. Well, Tennessee's has too.
Right.
I mean, they on talk radio, it's been their coach has been fired since September. So both of these teams have been through everything, and they're surviving.
Well, Perilou getting his second start of the season. And Elix Wilson, the backup linebacker, was the injured player. He's walking off by himself, but limping a little bit.
LSU is 9 for 15 on third down in this football game.
Perilou against Middle Tennessee, 20 of 25. Against Tennessee, 18 of 25. Third and 7. Flag down on the far side.
Dead ball, false start. Number 9, offense. 5-yard penalty, remains third down.
Well, I hate to open a wound for LSU fans, but it was Early Doucette, the senior wide receiver, who lined up illegally and negated a touchdown pass from Flynn to Hester.
He just flinched right in the slot right there.
And so it's third and 12. Incomplete. One hopper. Fourth down.
I don't even know if he got hit on that. I would not be shocked if we don't come back next time with Andrew Hatch. He might have got, did he get hit by Mayo or did the ball just go in the ground? Take another peek.
Mayo coming up the middle, got him from behind on the blitz.
Yeah, that, you got to give it to the Mayo on that one.
Patrick Fisher, only his second punt of the game, and he sails it again. He had one of 58 yards first time out. This one is taken by Dennis Rogan, number 41. And the tackle made by Jacob Hester, who plays special teams as well as do everything else for this LSU team. 55-yard punt, six on the return. Gerard Mayo, number seven, anchor of this Tennessee defense.
And now, it's time for our Geico scoring recap.
Tennessee got the first touchdown of the game. Chris Brown, a deflected 11-yard reception. They're up 7-0. And then LSU called on Colt David, a 30-yard field goal to cut the margin to 7-3. It was David again from 30 yards out. That made it 7-6. He missed another 30-yarder as the half ended. Demetrius Byrd, a 27-yard touchdown reception from Ryan Perilous, 13-7. And then after a fumble recovery, Eric Ainge finds Josh Crisco for the touchdown. That's where we stand at 14-13. At this moment of the game, I'm a big fan of low-scoring football.
Yeah.
Look at this. This is, they're tending to Ryan Perilous again.
I believe it's just a finger unless they're amputating and putting one on.
You and I are thinking the same thing.
Really?
I mean, they're secretive about their injury reports, but we all know it's a finger.
That's right.
And unless they're cutting it off, what is the problem?
Oh gosh.
Well, there's Foster, who's tackled at the 19-yard line. Luke Sanders.
One of the goals for Tennessee in this football game was to affect the two safeties for LSU, especially Stelz, not letting him come up and back and up and back. Seems to me that they've done an all right job in the pass game, but not in the run game.
Second down, 8. Eric Ainge rolling out, fires it behind his intended receiver, Austin Rogers. Civil war going on out west. Let's get an update from Tim.
All right, Vern, and Oregon could be Sun Bowl bound on CBS. And 21 straight Oregon points. Justin Roper, the fourth-string quarterback, taking it in. It's now 28-21. I disagree, Vern. I think those Oregon State unis look a little bit like the Broncos pre-Floyd Little when you were calling games. Back to you.
Yes, indeed. And if they are going to the Sun Bowl, they're going to be welcomed by Jimmy Rogers and the crew in El Paso and have the time of their lives. Third down and 8. Ainge under pressure. It'll be fourth down.
The adjustment Bo Pelini has made because of an injured Dorsey, I'll bet he would like to have it back last week. Because this time a three-man line, he cross-blitzes the linebackers, and that time, if Eric Ainge didn't throw it away, it was going to be a sack.
So, Colquitt is on, Chad Jones. Nothing unforeseen. LSU should have pretty good field position out of this. Colquitt. Brother Dustin punting with the Chiefs. Good protection, and here's Jones going right. Has it at the 40. Good downfield coverage. My goodness. Nick Reveille with the tackle. Backup linebacker. 13:41 to go. Tennessee leads LSU. That's the LSU coach. First down and 10. Don't forget, later in the game tonight, the five-star play of the game presented by Wrangler. LSU trailing by 1. And they have a first down, their best field position of the game, to start a drive. Draw play, Hester. A couple of yards.
That Tennessee front is stiffened up, don't they? LSU without Flynn, and then losing Keelan Williams has taken LSU out of their option game and forced Trindon Holiday back in the game as a backup, a tailback, when they want to run the option game. And now with a cut finger, it's another thing to call your game around if you're Gary Croton.
Ryan Perilou injured his finger late third quarter. Second down. Left side, caught by Early Doucette. And an update on the injury to Ryan Perilou. Here's Tracy.
Yeah, guys, Perilou was in a lot of pain on the sideline. He completely bled through the bandage when he came off after that last drive. They cleaned it up with peroxide. They added some gauze and some tape on it. I was told the hardest thing is stopping it from bleeding. They said he probably needs stitches, but they won't do anything now. They'll have to continue to tape it up each time he comes off the field.
All right, thank you, Trace. And 1 of 4 since the injury. And you can see the blood is already soaked through the bandage again. Here's the blitz coming up the middle. Perilou finds Doucette. It'll be fourth down.
I would not be surprised. Again, I would not be surprised if they don't go to Hatch very quickly here, because it looks like Perilou is limited, and now Doucette is down.
Early Doucette, who missed 4 full games, almost all of a fifth, with a groin injury in the middle of the season.
Well, Early Doucette got the ball on back-to-back plays. Here's the screen on the third down call. Gets hit right there and stays down. On the second down call, he seemed to me not to have that normal burst that we've seen from Doucette. Man, oh man. Tennessee playing physical or what?
Andrew Hatch, he has played in 1 game this year. He mopped up for Ryan Perilou. Tonight on CBS, Tom Selleck stars as Jesse Stone in Sea Change, followed by a new edition of 48 Hours Mystery. Tonight on CBS, America's most watched network.
Burned by alignment, Tennessee must show LSU that if you fake it, we'll be ready, and they did do that.
And here is the fake. It's caught over the middle. Quinn Johnson, number 45. There's a flag down.
It should be people downfield, should it? Was the ball caught behind the line of scrimmage? That'll be the key.
The flag is at the 46-yard line. Quinn Johnson's second catch of the year.
Was the ball caught behind the line of scrimmage?
There is no foul for an eligible downfield. The pass was caught behind the line of scrimmage.
The yard line is the 45-yard line. You just knew there was going to be a fake. Watch the 45-yard line. Tennessee covers the wide guys, but not the inside guys. It's caught behind the line of scrimmage, therefore the lineman can go downfield.
From Patrick Fisher, that's the second time we have seen, well, no, it's not the second time.
Right,
we've seen several. How many?
Right,
we've seen a lot of gadget plays out of fourth down, the most memorable of which, of course, was the Matt Flynn toss against South Carolina over the shoulder to Colt David for a touchdown. Here is Quinn Johnson, the junior football fullback. And a discussion continues. Well, the first fake field goal against South Carolina. This one, one of my all-time favorite plays. Flynn with a blind toss to Colt David. And nice smile then again. Here's Flynn, picks it up, runs right into Florida game.
Right. Well, I believe the Tennessee bench warned their defense to look for the fake. It was just a well-executed fake. They backed off. They didn't have all their men on the line of scrimmage, but Les Miles rolled the dice, and it worked.
First down and 10 with 12:03 to go. Quinn Johnson with the catch. His second reception of the year. Perilou, play fake. Deep left side for Bird. Man on man, too far. And he was open.
Well, they ran a stutter to the top of the field. with LaFell. Let's see if it's a stutter to the bottom of the field. Yes, it is a stutter. Gets open, but decent coverage. It would have had to have been a perfect throw. I mean, you know, yes, you could put that in there. That's still a 45-yard throw. Coverage like that on a stutter is acceptable. I mean, you can't cover these guys like a blanket, and he forced a perfect throw, and it was not.
Second down and 10. LaFell in motion. Blitz. Perilou. Out to his right. Finds Bird, and he is popped. Oh, my gracious. Brent Vinson, the freshman.
Vinson gets him, but Xavier Mitchell, number 93, forces the high throw. He sees Mitchell in the way, and Vinson just levels him. Had to put a little air under it. And man, Vinson, who was a wide receiver when we did the Florida game with Tennessee, is now full-time in defensive backfield.
Vinson on the left, Bird on the right. Third and 10.
Vinson's finding that it's better to give than to receive.
You're going biblical on it. LaFell hurries over to the right side, third and 10. Penalty.
It's a good thing, too, because LSU had an illegal formation. Tolliver lined up on the line of scrimmage, and it would have been a penalty.
Dead ball, false start, 65, offense, 5-yard penalty, remains third down.
That's the fifth of the game, I believe, but look at the illegal formation. Tolliver's on the line of scrimmage. He covers up Dixon. Dixon goes out. That would have been an illegal play.
Ninth penalty of the game against Louisiana State. Tennessee without a blemish here in the fourth quarter.
Tolliver lines up wrong again.
Here's the toss. Holiday gets a block from LaFell, and Holiday is popped. Eric Berry got there.
Man, I'll tell you, this game has turned into a fight for the SEC championship, hasn't it? Both offenses struggling a bit. Now both defenses are taking shots, and Eric Berry almost had another knockout.
Fourth and 5. And the punting unit comes on.
Will be a 58-yarder. I remember he tried a 57-yarder at the end of a game, but I think the better strategy here is to punt him deep.
Play field position.
Holiday is limping off, by the way. Trindon Holiday is limping very badly.
Yes, he is. Keelan Williams, one of the running backs, already out. And here's Fisher. Rogan is back. Comes to the near side with this one. Fair catch called. Oh, baby. Oh. Out of bounds at the 9. Les Miles, LSU, poise. He said it twice. .10:50 remaining in the game. Let's go down to Tracy Wolves.
Thanks, guys. A very busy LSU training staff. I was just told wide receiver Early Doucette out for the game with a right shoulder injury.
All right. He joins a growing list in this battle of attrition. Trindon Holiday limped badly as he went off.
And Perilou's playing with a finger that has obviously limited his throwing.
Worst field position for either team to start a drive. This is at the 9. Backs in the eye. Ainge pulls it out and fires it too high for Austin Rogers, and that gives us a chance to go to Tim Brando for this Heisman watch presented by Nissan.
All right, Vern, the backyard brawl tonight for West Virginia's Pat White. He's averaging 100 rushing yards at quarterback for the nation's second-ranked team. A win, and they're in the BCS championship. Hawaii is in good shape for a BCS bowl berth. Colt Brennan would be on the receiving end of the winner of your game between LSU and Tennessee. And how about the play of Todd Reesing of the Jayhawks? Back to you, Vern.
Been a heck of a year. Here's Ainge. He's missed his last 5. He gets this one, but it's only out to the 13-yard line. Josh Briscoe. Eric Ainge, the senior.
He's managed this game well. He got away with one early, survived what could have been an interception, and he's played above average. Can he turn it on and steal an SEC championship? That's his goal.
Third and five. Tennessee holds on to a one-point lead. They have yet to turn the ball over, and they have yet to have a penalty. And they're looking at a third and five with a one-point lead as we reach the 10-minute mark. Inside, picked off. Jonathan Zeenon, touchdown.
Was wide open on the play.
The senior from Bro Bridge, Louisiana.
Looks like LSU will go for two.
That is the first turnover of the night. And they will go for two.
Now you would assume it would be an option play here.
Quinn Johnson goes right. Hester is alongside Perilou. Perilou keeps it. 2 points.
Kind of a zone read. Eric Ainge busted one here. Had an inside rub. He got greedy and he went outside. Watch the inside rub play. This guy's going to come up, pick, and right off inside of it is wide open. He goes to the outside. Watch the inside guy wide open. He gets the rub for an easy completion inside. He goes outside, and it costs them.
Zeenon with the touchdown, his first of the year. Here's the two-pointer as Perilou skips into the end zone, and he gets the plaudits of his teammate Glenn Dorsey. LSU leads it 21-14. Tiger faithful travel well, don't they? They come out and support their team, and they're happy right now. Eric Ainge throws the interception. Jonathan Zeenon grabs it and runs it in untouched. Sean Godet will kick off. Rogan and Lennon Creer are the deep two for Tennessee. This is Creer at the nine. Oh, wow. Chad Jones. Les Miles told us last week he is going to become, well, he already is a good player.
Yeah, he will be an All-American.
Yes, indeed.
If he plays, you know, he's a baseball player, too. But here's the interception again. Jonathan Zeenon never backs up a step. Look at that. He never backs up a step. He does not believe that Tennessee's going to go deep. You have to get the secondary out of their back pedal. Ainge lets it go. Flat out misread it. Flat out misread it. It was Ainge's fault. Now, can he come back and make up for it?
First down at the 23. Play fake. He rolls out to his left. Fires the ball. It's caught by Briscoe. And Briscoe drags a tackler near the first down yarder.
It has not been pretty for Eric Ainge against LSU in his history.
You're being kind.
Well,
remember the memorable game, of course, after Katrina.
I remember him.
Monday night down in New Orleans when this Tennessee team.
And the bad ankle last year.
Right. Now they came back and won that one, and then he missed most of last year's game with a bad ankle. It's second down and one. Handoff. Foster appears. Well, remember that the Monday night game post Katrina between these two and also post Rita. Here's the pass that we're talking about. Eric Ainge in desperation throws it out. It was intercepted and an easy touchdown. Look at his career numbers against the Tigers.
Yeah, but he's still in this football game, and he's got a chance. We remember Jamarcus Russell last year in that game, and he threw that fourth down pass to win it. Still a football game.
Ainge goes deep. Austin Rogers, Zeenon's there, tips it away, no flag.
Well, I thought that There could have been a little interference on that one. You get a play picked off, so you go right back at the same guy. Does Zenon put his hand on his back? Yeah, I think that one could have been called. That one could have been called.
The head football coach at Tennessee was 15 yards out onto the field after
this.
Don't
blame him.
Yep.
Put one hand on the back. Not only could have, should have been called. Well, he didn't have as good a view as we did. That was pass interference.
Second down and 10. Play fake again. Little crossing routes caught by Briscoe. He's out of bounds with the first down at the 45-yard line.
See, that's the matchup that Tennessee would love to have. You have Briscoe on stelts. The big difference of the safeties here for LSU from this year to last year is they do not play good man-to-man coverage. Stelts cannot run with Briscoe. They got the matchup and they took advantage of it.
Gain of 20, a first down at the 45 with 8:43 to go. At stake, a berth in the Sugar Bowl. And the SEC championship.
Because of the safeties, it almost forces LSU into playing zone defense.
Denarius Moore, number 83, top of the screen. They come up and press him. Hand off Foster coming to the right, chased by Beckwith. And Zenon also in there to make the tackle, numbers 19 and 48. Five to go. Well, we talked about the tumultuous week for this LSU football team. They lost their chance at the national championship when they lost to Arkansas last Friday, a week ago Friday. And then all of the speculation all week long. Will he or won't he go to Michigan, his alma mater? Talking about Les Miles. Called a rare, unusual press conference. Here's Ainge back. It's caught. Denarius Moore, number 83, and that's a first down at the 27-yard line.
I'll tell you what happened here. Stelts was disguising the blitz so much that he came very late. Stelts comes late. LSU is playing a kind of a zone. See how Zenon bails because he's playing deep third. You got a zone blitz. But Stelts comes free, but he comes too deep, and he never can get the pressure on Eric Ainge before the ball is thrown.
First down at the 27-yard line. It's Foster. Starts left, comes right, works his way down to the 23-yard line.
Well, if you're Eric Ainge, you go, wait a second, I let him from 16 down against Vandy. I just played four overtimes against Kentucky. What's the big deal here? It's kind of fun.
Ainge with 156 yards in this half.
I love quarterbacks who come after adversity and just pick it up right from there.
Play change.
Unless you're playing a two deep zone here.
Hand off Foster. Yard perhaps two. 21-14 LSU. Tennessee scored on the opening drive of the game. Went up 7-0. It was 7-6 at the half. LSU got a touchdown catch from Demetrius Byrd to take a lead. Tennessee got a turnover, first fumble in more than 600 carries by the LSU running backs. They converted that into a touchdown, and then just a few moments ago, Bo Pelini's cornerback, Jonathan Zenon, stepped in front of a pass that was intended for Quentin Hancock, took it in untouched, and the try for two was good, 21-14, with 6:32 to go. LSU has just opted to call a timeout. Tonight's lineup on CBS will begin with Tom Selleck starring as Jesse Stone in Sea Change, and that's followed by 48 Hours Mystery. That is the lineup tonight on CBS.
All right, now Philip Fulmer has to be thinking ahead here. 6:22 or 32, whatever it is left in the game. If you don't get real close for a fourth down try, you could kick a field goal and win it late with a touchdown. Could still kick a field goal here. You do not have to go four down territory. Now, if they pick up 3 or 4 yards, or of course make the first down, you're okay. But there's still a lot of decision to be made if you're Philip Fulmer.
Hancock is wide to the left, Quentin Hancock. Foster comes up to listen to his quarterback, Eric Ainge. It's third and four. LSU with three down. They rush only three. They get a little pressure and the pass is incomplete. Intended for Denarius Moore, number 83.
I wonder if it was Raheem Alem, number 84, that put the pressure on Ainge and forced a high throw. Because he was wide open. Was there a hand? No, I really can't make it. Really what it, part of it was that Denarius Moore couldn't find the quarterback and didn't see the ball. Now, here's the decision by Philip Fulmer. He's going to go for it.
And the Volunteers not nearly as successful on fourth down this year. Just over 50% converted. 8 of 15. Fourth and four.
Three-man line.
Rush three, drop eight. Ainge drills it. Dropped. It was a little behind Denarius Moore.
You're right. A good throw would have had it. He had the matchup again. Denarius Moore on Ollie Highsmith. He ran right by Ollie Highsmith and Ainge threw it behind him. It demanded a good throw. Eight men drop. You see Highsmith. He doesn't see the ball. Could and should have been caught. I'll give you that. But we both saw the same thing. It was right off Highsmith's shoulder, and it was not a perfect throw, and of course, not a great catch.
Philip Fulmer will give you the visual. So, for that matter, will Les Miles.
I mean, you expect if you're Tennessee, both your guys to do a little better. Quarterback to throw it a little better, and your receiver to come up with the catch.
First down and 10, Louisiana State. The handoff to Hester. Out to the 27-yard line. Tackle made by Xavier Mitchell. Clock now at 6:10. You know, Both teams, excuse me, Gary.
I really don't have much of a problem with the call right there. I mean, we've already missed field goals for Tennessee. You give it two shots. If you get the ball back, you still have a chance to tie it. You know, I think it was worth the gamble.
Second and four. Ainge now 17 of 36 for even 200. Perilou has hit two-thirds of his passes, and he's played much of this half with an injured index finger on his throwing hand. Here's Hester. It'll be third down. Twenty-five seniors for this LSU team. Began this season with the aspirations of the national championship. They were a preseason number two pick. And then with that great start, I mean, they won at Mississippi State 45-0. They demolished Virginia Tech, and Virginia Tech is a BCS bowl-bound team now. But then they struggled, won some close games here on third and two. And they've dialed up Hester's number defensively, and that is short.
Yes, it is short. Fourth and very short.
I don't think so. I think you punt here. No?
I don't know.
Oh, yeah. I forgot. We're dealing with Les Miles.
I know. Let me call up. Did he sign the $30 million contract first? If he's got the money in the bank, maybe he goes for it.
Perfect. And, of course, we're referring to the fact that Les Miles called a press conference 2 hours before this game started to say that he had agreed in principle to a contract to remain at LSU. And that's where we stand. Here's Fisher. High. Fair catch call by Rogan. And he grabs it at the 33-yard line. Little collision. One of the officials slipped and fell down. And then we had a couple of players who got into a late collision. So. 36-yard punt. Well, 90 seconds to go against South Carolina. Philip Fulmer's team was trailing, and they escaped that one with a field goal in overtime. They scored 16 in the fourth quarter. Honfeld's bid for a field goal grazed an upright, and then, of course, last week they won in four overtimes against Kentucky. They've played a lot of football, as has LSU, in the last 8 weeks, 8 days. There's the pass complete. Josh Briscoe, number 81, with the catch. Stelts is down. Let's go back to Tim in New York.
All right, Vern, look for the UCLA job to possibly be vacant at the end of the week. USC needs a win for the Rose Bowl berth. John David Booty to Fred Davis. That makes it 24-7. Carl Durrell's in some trouble. Staying in the Pac-10 in Eugene, 28-all between Oregon and Oregon State. Back to Vern.
All right, thanks. Second down and one, and here's Foster with the handoff. That'll be a first down. The clock shows 3:37. It stops now while the chain is moved.
And for all intents and purposes now, it's overtime. You know, LSU has a 7-point lead. Tennessee has the football. Under 4 minutes to go. They've got to score a touchdown to tie, and they'll use four downs to do it.
Ainge up on first down and 10. Ball at the 46. Four-man front for LSU. Ainge puts it out in the flat. And Chad Jones is there to secure the tackle on Arian Foster.
Yeah, that would have been a good throwaway that time if you were Eric Ainge on first down. Chad Jones was out there, and he was not going for the pump fakes. One pump fake, looks upfield, turns and throws it again. That would have been a good time to sail that one right out of bounds.
Loss of seven. It's second and 17. 3 minutes to go. Play fake. Pressure from Tyson Jackson. The pass is caught by Foster. He gets a block on Zenon. Foster out of bounds at the 15.
The last thing I checked is this is the SEC, right?
Yeah.
It's going to go right down to the end. I mean, it's getting to be like NBA basketball here. Fake it and then throw it to the same guy. You had a defensive tackle spying on the running back, and the defensive tackle could not do it. Good block downfield on Zenon, and Foster takes it right down and puts it in the scoring zone.
That block was by Quentin Hancock, number 87. First down at the 15 after the 47-yard play. Ainge with a play fake, fires it, intercepted. Picked off by Gary Beckwith.
Beckwith just kind of pattern reads this. The middle linebacker, he's right there. Let's keep his eye on him. I did not see the play. I was looking downfield. He follows. He looks at Age's eyes. He finds the receiver and reacts to the receiver. That's called pattern reading if you're a linebacker. Find the receiver, go to the receiver, and he just beat the throw there.
Beckwith injured on the play, gets up and signals to the fans. Bo Pelini comes out. He's learned the chest bump.
Well, quarterback's job is to find linebackers when you're throwing the curls. And that time, Eric Ainge did not find the linebackers. He thought he had a one-on-one. He had a zone guy in the middle. He didn't get it to the right person. Oh.
And so the ball goes over. Here is Perilou handing off to Hester. And we've got 2:35 to go in this SEC championship game.
Obviously, game's not over. I don't think LSU's going to be happy to throw the ball with Perilou's finger. They don't want a mistake. Let's see the strategy they use.
Second down, seven. 21-14. Difference in the ball game score-wise now is that Zenon interception returned for a touchdown.
Use the whole time clock. You should be able to play clock. Excuse me. You should get it down to under three when you snap it.
Done. Hester. Out to the 15. Now the key play in the game. Eric Ainge coming right and throwing it right to Jonathan Zenon. And then there was the drop pass, right?
The Briscoe hits him in the helmet, and then they come right back with an interception the next time down the field. Woo! Eric Ainge, what a day.
Time now for the Ruby Tuesday player of the game, Ryan Perilou. Going the distance in place of Matt Flynn, 20 of 30 in his second start of the season for 243. One touchdown, one interception, and much of this half playing with an injured index finger on his right hand. Oh, look at this. Perilou's got it. Still running, and he's out of bounds. Chased there by Gerard Mayo with the first down.
Well, he did everything right but go out of bounds. It's going to cost him 25 seconds. Remember, Jacob Hester was stuffed last time on third and two. This time, it's the naked bootleg. Now, Ryan, good job. Now get out. Just slide. And the clock keeps going. You move the chains, they stop the clock, but then they get a full 25 seconds.
And so the clock remains stopped until the snap. Brandon LaFell breaks and goes wide right. Tennessee can stop it once more with a timeout. Hester. And timeout has been called. By Tennessee. That's their last.
Now, I'll tell you what's going to happen. Because Perilou did not go out of bounds, it looks like LSU will have to punt the ball with 15 seconds to go, roughly. Had he not gone out of bounds, the game would be over right now.
That's assuming no more first downs.
That's correct.
Yeah. So Tennessee has used its last timeout. 1:42 to go.
I played on one of those teams that never got the first down in this situation. So we have,
I can tell you're channeling bad memories. Right. Now it's time for the five-star play of the game presented by Wrangler. Here's Jim Hawthorne of the LSU Radio Network.
And there's the snap. Here comes the Tiger rush. Here's the pass. It is intercepted. Sinan, touchdown!
My, 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 what LSU needed, and I mean right at the right time. Jonathan Sinan, the left corner.
Jonathan Sinan with the interception return for a touchdown. Second down and eight. Oh, late pitch. Hester gets a good block. He scored on an 87-yarder.
Ball game.
Earlier this season, that's a gain of 20.
You never would have thought that LSU would put the ball in the air. They really didn't forward. They put it in the air backward, and they gave it to their most dependable guy. They pick up the first down. And now Jacob Hester goes over 100 yards and takes his team to the championship at the same time.
Had 126 in the overtime loss to Arkansas. He's now carried 23 times for 120. And he's going to get to play on New Year's, right after the New Year, in the Sugar Bowl. And 1,000 yards for Jacob Hester.
How about that? Couldn't happen to a better guy and more symbolic of what this football team was all year.
Perilou takes a knee. And Tennessee cannot stop the clock. Eric Ainge.
Tennessee was valiant, don't you think?
Oh, my gosh, yes. Glenn Dorsey. Oh, we hope he heals. He's got a month to do so. I agree with you, Gary. It was that chop block against Auburn that changed the nature of the season for this LSU team.
I absolutely believe that they would be playing for the national championship without that chop block.
Bradley Dale Pivotow, the linebacker coach, with a hug for Les Miles. Glenn Dorsey, Marlon Favorite, number 99. This is a team that has lost twice this year, both times in triple overtime. They lost at Kentucky. They lost to Arkansas. But they come to Atlanta, and Les Miles, on the day he announced his intention to remain at LSU, out in the center of the field. Final score, 21-14. The LSU Tigers. Let's quickly go down to Tracy.
Coach, congratulations. A berth in the Sugar Bowl. With all the distractions this week, how much does this win mean to you guys?
Just really happy for our seniors, our leadership. It's a group of guys that came together. We talked about it all week. This wasn't scripted. This wasn't the best team coming in with all the talent healthy. You know, some of our best players are watching this from the sidelines. And so we had to put it together, and this team did that. We're thrilled, absolutely thrilled.
Go enjoy it. Thanks a lot, Coach.
Might be the last time we see Bolt Bellini on the LSU sidelines. Well, that concludes a heck of a season for us here in the SEC. The final score, 21-14. For Tracy Wolfson, Gary Danielson, our entire crew, who are on the road every week covering SEC football. We say good night from Atlanta.